Pat just checking out whether the black goes back into the middle or might be on in the corner too, I'm not sure, maybe not. I think by the way he tried to move it there, I'd say it's probably not quite on. Tried for a big shot there, played the cut and to open up the black. He's managed to take the hole though, so Robbo's got to get behind that yellow up the top. A little bit of work to do here. He's played a played the snooker on both balls. He has given Patrick maybe just a baby swerve here to clip the one in over the corner. Yep. Oh, and he's missed it. Two shots. That could be costly. Especially if he knocks this in one. Yep. Ooh, he might be stuck to the yellow there. Mark decides to just bump on out since he's got two shots. Now everything's nice and easy. Three roll-ins and the black. Sometimes when you're in that situation and you haven't got an easy pot on, it's not a bad idea just to bounce the hardest ball out into the open and leave yourself with three easy pots to finish off, rather than try and take on a fine cut somewhere. Nicely round for the black. One nil to Mark. Steve Jamieson lays the snooker. It's a very nice shot. Brett tries to do here. Pretty much If he hits the red closest to the yellow, he might not leave too much with the white if he doesn't pot it. Ah, he's missed it. Two visits. Could be big trouble. Jamo decides to use his two, just bounce it out. And roll it in. Is that one all? Mark with the reds here. And just joining me in the commentary booth is one of Victoria's best, 2014 state player Nathan Harris. He's just picking up the mic now. Welcome, Yarra.
Hello, Poggy. Hello, everyone that's watching it out there in cue ball land. Who we got up here? We got Robbo and Woody.
Yeah, Robbo's on the air.
And we got King Egg and Stephen Jamison, Mr. Pro-Am himself. And we've got the other matches not on camera at the moment.
We got Paul Brewer's playing, I think, Michael Scarry.
Okay, and I think we've got Peter Butterworth versus the winner of Dale Watson and Jamie Stevens, which may have just finished. So we'll get a winner on that result, or winner on that match. And Jamie's just giving his cue a bit of a wipe down, and generally you don't do that after you've lost. So. And Robbo,
come a little short.
Just a little bit short there. A little bit of swerve here, and
good to see Robbo's got his Sunday best on.
Hope to get the. There's quite a few dressed like that. I figure if it works for Robbo, it might work for others. And I just played Robbo in the last 16, and maybe I should have worn the old trackies as well.
Yeah, 4-3, I heard, was it?
I was 4-3, 3-all, and that's. Hit by Robbo, but yeah, we was 3-all, and I thought it'd be a brilliant idea to foul break in the last frame. So and needless to say, I did not get another opportunity. So so good thing I have a brain, because I don't know how to break to save my life. So at least I can think my way through frames.
Here we are. We got a few scores up now.
You might have to scratch that bottom right name, mate. I'm sitting here with you. I'm happy to take it, mate, if it's okay with Jamie, but yeah.
Patrick's just laid the evil snooker there.
Yeah, it was $1.04 that was going to happen. So Robbo looked to play a little bit of swerve, come off the, and maybe get a snooker back here. I don't know, he's played it with a bit of pace. Yeah.
Dangerous.
Thought he might have just played a little bit of swerve there and just tickled it under behind the black, or killed the black a little bit more. But opened it up for Patrick, and you know, Patrick's had some good results. Everyone knows that over the last 6 to 8 months. So he'll look to tidy these up and send it to 1-1.
Yeah, pretty.
Who got you, Pikey? I didn't see your who got you.
I just lost in the last round to Paul Brewer.
Paul Brewer.
Yeah, he played pretty well.
We overhit that one a little bit, but no real drama still. I like those balls to finish off in any no matter how good you are.
Yeah, it's pretty much three stuns, isn't it? Stun. Roll the black in.
Yep. Took your advice, Paul. So it's been a while since we've had one of these pro-am tourneys. So I think the last time was, it may have been around March, would you say? Around about March, right?
Yeah.
Obviously there's been a lot of tournaments in between with state titles, the Anzac Comp, the big guns, various other things as well. But
Jammo's overcut that. You can't get away with that against the king.
So it's good to get this comp up and running again, and obviously it'll probably be the last one before the Nationals, and we'll kick off again.
Which ball will he play for here?
I think he'll, yep, well,
he's played,
he has
for,
to play the high, yeah, the one that's higher, so yeah, he's obviously he naturally roll across and play the other one.
Another headset, so I can do special comments for Patrick's.
If you want to build a
fan base,
I'll need a pathway. All right, so Brett's about to wrap this up.
Brett's
just tickled it in there. So
2-1
speed up on the way through, but yep.
Patrick Hood back to against Robbo. I'll give you a quick. Ben Hood wants to give you a rundown on Patrick at the moment.
I'll just commentate this next round. Mackers is off and running. Have a look at him go. He's been trying for 24 years to emulate his older brother, and he's not far off. Is this a mutual commentary, or do I just have to run the whole thing?
Well, it will be in a second.
I can tell you something of a personal note about Patrick. Is his development as a player over the last probably 12, 18 months. The major difference has been he starts to believe. Like even with that shot, in the old days he would have tried to screw back, get on that, hold it, whereas these days he understands, I'm good enough, just run through with a little bit of check, hold the ball.
Well, before you got here, Benny, I was actually saying what a good 6 to 8 months Patrick's had, so the boys down here are well aware of what he's doing. He does play a comp down in Melbourne on a Monday night, which I'm a part of, so I do get a chance to see him every week, and he's definitely on the up, that's for sure.
The interesting thing I think with him as a player is going to be his next 12 months. Whether he pushes to that next level, He's competitive now against anyone he plays against. Right. And you see that now, even against Robbo on a Sunday night comp worth a few hundred bucks. To him, it means everything. But the question's going to be, over the next 6, 12, 18 months, does he push that like the Jack McCartneys and the have and just take it to another level?
Yeah, well, I probably wouldn't be raising the bar that high just yet. I mean, he's had a lot of... some significant improvement, but you know, if he wants to get to those guys, he's going to have to as you said, what does he want to do? Does he want to? Because if he does, he's going to have to play. You know, if he's playing a lot now, he's going to have to play another probably twice as much.
All his time and his commitment that he puts into the game, without question, he's probably more than anyone in Geelong. The worst thing, I hope Geelong people aren't listening at the moment because this is probably going to bite me on the ass. But the problem with Geelong pool is it's almost like a cancer, and that's the difference between, you know, the DDPL and the Ballarats and the, those guys get around each other and they play all the time together. The best players play against each other. They're not scared to play for money, to push the limits. Whereas the Geelong boys tend to find an excuse at every avenue. As much as they're brilliant players, and I'm not going to name people, but there's some brilliant players out of our town, but in terms of being to a national standard or representing the country, they're not there yet. And they, for most of them, they probably never will be. That, for me, I find disappointing. And
certainly better than dumping the white somewhere or putting the yellow on a cushion.
My question then was whether Brett was going to play the snooker.
Yeah.
Like whether he just bots that gentle, runs over, hangs the other one over the bag.
Might find he'll look to play the bottom yellow here and just contain behind the wall. And I guarantee he wasn't trying to hit that red.
No, I don't even have any funny comments for that one. That's going to hurt him.
Yeah, no doubt it should. JMO, confident pot there. And
we go to two all. And Patrick's in a little bit of trouble, but played a safety on the other
normally
table.
Normally switch to the next match, but Dan's just gone away. Here he comes back, and we might cross over to the Robbo-Patrick game. This one looks a bit delicately poised.
Here we go for a bit of bias commentary.
And Robbo's
playing the black down.
Play the black on the yellow and make it hard for Patrick to go out on these reds.
Has he hit that too hard?
No, I think he's played it nicely there. Very nice.
Wow, that is a beautiful shot.
But Patrick does have a chance here to knock both of those, that red and the black out.
Yeah,
in one
with
shot,
one shot, absolutely.
Just gotta get the white in the right spot to do it. And hopefully obviously you won't play it unless you have to.
I don't think he's going to play it now.
I don't know. Probably wait for a better spot than doing that.
He's just going to open him up, lay up again, pull another snooker.
Yeah, I would have probably had a crack at knocking them all out there.
Then Robbo's probably just going to push another red back down over that black. And
Either that or just tuck the white behind one red or something like that.
I feel like if Patrick had opened up these bottom two reds, potted one, and then played that open up shot, he's in a position to do some damage.
I thought he maybe could have just potted a couple of reds there and then improved the white position to extract those two balls.
Turn some traffic into trackers.
But, you know,
it's still not the worst result here.
Cause he's still in a good spot.
Robbo had a guess. I would assume he's probably just going to play the cannon here, the red under the red, push the red, double it into the bottom rail.
Yeah, either that or maybe look to play another red down there. It's either or. Well, he's just going to slow roll the white on top of the black here.
Dangerous shot there.
Very dangerous shot, but if he comes off,
if you're good enough.
He might have hit this a bit hard. No, it's sort of pulled up a bit. Good shot there. Makes it harder for Patrick to knock that black out now.
Fantastic judge of pace.
That's why I thought Patrick may have a crack at knocking those out now, but Robbo's just promoted that black a little bit. Makes it a little
bit
more.
Where would you sit now on a percentage scale of who's the favourite to win?
Look, I would
And what percentage? Where the balls lie now,
I'd say Robbo is probably still a 70% favourite, I would say.
But you're relying on Patrick to make a mistake there.
You are, but he still has to play. He still needs to play. Eventually, it's going to come down to that
ball.
He's got
to play that
ball. He has to come down to that ball. And then he has to be in a spot where he can knock it out and get a shot on it on the next visit. So that's why Robbo, I think, is 70% at the moment.
I'd like to hold judgment on that because I think we all... There's an element of chance involved in the shot, but we've all naturally played that shot where you come off the top rail, kick the black, back out in the centre of the table, and you've got a shot.
Yeah,
I don't think it's as a daunting shot.
No, it's not, but
with two in your hand.
It all depends on how hard up that black is on the yellow.
So Robbo's forcing his hand here and saying, all right, well, if you're good enough.
It's always going to come down to that. Patrick's going to snooker him, and Robbo's going to pot his reds and try and leave him a tough, awkward first shot.
I reckon Patrick's going to have a go from here, personally.
Yeah, and he probably should. So, and if it doesn't come off, he'll just hide again. You know? And Robbo will try and do the same thing again. Yeah, so Robbo probably shouldn't pot a red here, I think.
I think he'll cut the red across.
Now be the time to put the red down there over the black. There's not really a lot of safety options other than doing that.
But he still wants... It looks like he still wants to call his hand, which he's...
Just going to pot
it and say if you're good enough.
Continue to pop this red and send the white back down. Yep. And, it's on the other end, but...
He's got a big pocket down here, though, so...
Well, I think, Patrick, this is the time for him to go. Yep. He can't wait any longer.
Yeah.
Eventually he'll run out of balls and he'll end up playing... having a shot on the black that he doesn't want to play, so...
Well, that shot to kick the black up the arse. He's got the centre over the pocket perfectly to do that. Because he just runs into it naturally. If he leaves that till his last ball, even if he just nails this.
Yeah, I guarantee you he wanted to make that.
Oh, yeah.
And that's not ideal.
It's an interesting shot.
I'll probably just clip off. And White will come back down to close to... That was interesting.
I think given there's only two balls on the table, Robbo will stop trying to pot his balls here. I think he'll just play the train, cannon the ball, push the red over to that rail. There's not much Patrick can do from there. Not a chance he's on it, is there?
Yeah, I'm just saying, can he squeeze under it? But
even if he squeezes under it, he's got to have enough of it to come back without kicking a black onto the rail.
But I reckon what would be a shot is if you just nudge the black up the rail a little bit and it opens the yellow up and it leaves Patrick a really, really tough double to open with, but you've opened the yellow up as well.
Yep.
Yeah. No, he's not looking at it. Well, he was looking at it, but not going to play it. So he'll play the safer option there.
I wouldn't be surprised if Patrick plays the kiss here into the bottom right-hand pocket. Which he's going for, but missed by a healthy margin.
Play this.
He'll just pot it, just run underneath his head, leave him nothing.
Back down table again. Well, he's left Patrick a shot.
He's giving him half a show here because he gets a chance to get underneath the black.
Robbo would have liked to play it a little bit harder there, but anyway.
Patrick. And he can't afford to lay this up because Robo just pots it and leaves him wherever he wants. It's not the worst shot by Patrick. So the shot that we thought was coming 14 shots ago, he's finally played.
Yeah, and
now you'd say that Robbo's probably gone to a 95% chance of winning this throw. Unless that goes in.
That would have been quite funny given the potable balls that Patrick's had there, and he ended up making the long double. But bit of cat and mouse tactics for a little while here, I think, just until someone's entirely satisfied with where the white is and the ball they want to play.
I think Robbo's resigned to the fact that if he gets another shot, it'll be because he said to Patrick, have a go. He's in a position, why would you bother risking it and being impatient? You'd sit here for another 3 hours playing this game. Oh,
well,
he's giving him a little sniff here too.
And I think that's probably what Robbo's doing as well, just giving him a little teaser, just to
instead of playing the safety.
Yeah, because you can probably do that until the cows come home. That would have been perfect spot for him to land had he made that. But
Patrick's worn his high vis vest tonight just in case there's any OH&S issues, so there was a conscious call that he made before he left Geelong was if there's a construction issue on site, I'll be right.
He kind of rates that shirt a bit, doesn't he?
Yeah. I've not worn mine again since. It was just a bit bright for me.
Probably a fair call too, I reckon.
Well, it's generally, if you're having a beer or two, like, it gets brighter as the day goes on, so given that Patrick doesn't drink.
Yeah, even harder to believe that he'd be wearing that.
Yeah, for sure. If I had it on, I'd have an excuse, wouldn't I? I'm surprised why Robbo... To me, it would appear that he's sort of overthinking this. Why he wouldn't just run into it and leave Patrick on the right-hand rail. He can't kick it up the arse that way. You definitely can't go on the right-hand side of the black. It's almost like a free shot.
Right, so he with Robbo calling over, yeah, he's down decided to look at this, he may...
He's going to have a go at it.
He may have a look at getting it squeezing under the black here.
Can you see the logic in that?
Well, I can see the logic if he can get through there, which he obviously can, because as you say, he would...
Well, is he not a chance to kill in the black? Or...
So now he's just
going to play a snooker.
Yeah.
But he's given Patrick a chance now, where if he just pots Patrick's ball...
And has he left it where he can't glance off it without going in off? That's a...
I think he's a good enough player that...
Well, it's hard to tell from here how much distance he has between... I've no doubt that he will get behind it, but...
Whether it drops. These pockets do tend to drop.
They do.
That's one thing, yes.
They do slide, that's for sure.
Probably not the best game for a beginner in pool to sit here and watch and think that you're being thrilled, but it's been a really good game to watch from a tactical point of view in terms of even the best players showing perseverance and patience.
Now, Steve Jamieson, I've just noticed, has knocked in a black over there. Now, was that... They didn't shake hands after it, but on the screen it says 3-2.
I think that took Steve to 3-2 that frame.
Maybe just get a score check on that.
It should be 3-2 now. Because they were 2-all.
So where's Robbo going here?
He's having a go at it.
Oh, that's a great shot. That's a great shot. Yeah, so as I thought, he probably was a little bit of a sigh there from Robbo, as you can see there. It's like, how the hell did I get into that spot?
That is a massive shot.
But yeah, that just that tells me by playing that that he could not glance off that black and without
going couldn't run under it and hide. No, no. There was no hiding.
All right, so that's a big frame, that, being 2-1 down. So, yep.
Wow.
All right, so he has realised that he's won, so it is now 4, because there was no handshake there, so...
is that over now? Is that 4-2 on their table?
Yeah, 4-2, so Steve into the semi in his Love Child tournament. So, well done to Steve.
Are you and the viewers, would you be familiar with Boris Krasik?
Oh, I think most of us are, yeah.
Do you notice any similarities in mannerisms between Patrick and Boris?
In terms of pool?
Not on the table. I mean, say when they miss a shot.
I don't know. They're not down. I don't see enough of the guys play to really study their mannerisms and so forth, but. I know Davey a bit more than Boris, but yeah.
Well, there's another great example. The body language that comes across.
All right, so Robbo's probably got the perfect layout for to come off to win a long tactical battle. So come off and. Break and get presented with these easy balls.
These is just each shot's just about holding.
Yep.
Just
yep.
Pot,
yep.
Hold, pot, yep. Hold, pot, hold.
Yep.
So for the beginners that just watch the tactical battle, as opposed to the people that are watching at the moment, it's a great example of how to simplify an out that can also easily be mucked up. Mark won't muck it up because he's too much of a class player, but I'm sure we've all played many, many a frame where you've looked at the table and thought your opponent's going out, there's no way they can miss, and then you still end up at the table yourself.
And Robbo's probably didn't land where he wanted there, but still not going to be a problem. I guarantee the red that he takes now, he would have wanted that to be his last ball.
Yeah.
It just didn't come down enough, but he just needs to roll through. And pretty much, well, just roll through on this one and come back out close to where the white is at the moment. Yeah, that's perfect.
It's just really nice contact. Yeah. That's all it is. It's.
And anyone will tell you, it's just like, you want one of these frames after a 20 minute, especially if you lose them.
Yeah.
But if you win them, like if you get that frame and then you break and you're left with that.
Yeah, well, it's funny, isn't it?
Picked up a freebie and the other guy's deflated. So.
We're looking at the score now, 2-3, Mark in front. Mark's in the previous frame, gone across the table, clipped the black and potted it. If he misses that, then he's 3-1 down.
All right, so you can see the matches are sort of taking shape here. 2-1 completed match. Obviously, Butters and Jamie will probably be the last one to finish. Jamie will be tiring the hell out of
Potted
Butters
off the break here.
Like
what's
that.
He got?
He's got his match
one red and two yellows. And I think that he'll... Pretty confident he won't be playing any safeties here. I think he's going to have a go.
No doubt.
I think his brother would be disappointed if he didn't have a go.
No doubt. So it's a fickle game sometimes, you're busting your ass for 20 minutes to get a frame, you don't get it, and then you don't get a look in.
I tell you, I'm quite surprised he went for the red then. I thought the yellow went inside there and he would have just made that look really, really simple. He's left himself a little bit of work now.
Yeah, this is, to me, this is the frame ball right here. So yeah, because if he gets, he'll just roll through nicely. But that's the frame ball. So he'd be looking just to roll red on red here. Yeah, take the red,
take the red
over,
and run it down the rail.
Take the red down the rail, and then basically he's got a ball over the centre pocket, and the ball he can knock in the corner, and the black in the middle of the table. Yep.
Yeah, I was going to say, I reckon he'll take this centre. Well, he definitely will now, but if he'd left the ball over the centre and the ball over the right hand pocket, he's potentially leaving himself a snooker.
So just stunned out, so he didn't have any awkward queuing there. If he just rolled that in, he'd be probably half bridging over the top of the yellow and making the shot a little bit harder. Now it's basically just nice queuing down the rail, and you don't need to do anything. Just two. It's basically
three
rolls.
Everything's about make the pot.
It's basically three rolls from here.
He's part of that. Do you think we'll see a couple of fist pumps at the end of this frame?
I don't think so. No.
But it'd be nice to see a bit of enthusiasm in victory. You know, like treat it a little bit like American football. Put something on for the crowd at home.
Yeah, I think it was maybe three all. It might, you might be a bit different, but yeah, it's just run two racks there, and Patrick could consider himself a bit stiff there.
Yeah.
Not a lot he could have done. He was right in the match, and then basically lost a long tactical battle, and that was, even though it was 2-2, it was, you didn't get to the table.
The beauty of the game is also the evil of the game, which is you need a little bit of luck and you need things to go your way to a certain degree to get over the line, and Mark's just shown he persevered, he played a shot that we didn't necessarily think he was going to play there in that other frame. And then he's come out, nailed the black, and gone, see you later, the next two frames. Closed out the match. It's pretty hard to not take your hat off to him for that.
No. When the other guy doesn't give you a chance to beat you, there's, you know, you can only say, too good, you know. Lick your wounds and come back for the next one. All right, so who we got here? We got
Mick Scarry and
Paul Gruen. I think Mick was up 3-1, I think. 3-2. Okay.
It's a bit of a pity we haven't got Joel Younger here for special comments after a couple of beverages. I think he'd have some interesting things to say.
Yeah.
He's in the Gold Coast at the moment.
We're getting the argument here, so yeah. Quite the entertaining person when he's had a few sherbets.
Yes, certainly. He's a level above Billy, that's for sure.
Alright, so
we've got Paul in the yellow here playing the train, I assume.
Alright, someone just sent me a text saying, who the hell am I commentating with? So, if anyone don't know, this is Ben Hood, so Patrick's brother. So, haven't seen you down these traps for a while,
I don't get the opportunity. I play football, so football season's basically a write-off for me in terms of pool, and then some of the weather's too good, so I don't want to play pool. I'm
one
out.
Of the smart ones.
Yeah, so what I have made a conscious decision of is maybe when I'm sort of hit my 40s and 50s, I'll put a bit of time into pool because I'll be looking for an outlet out of the home. But at the moment, I've learned just to enjoy my pool for what it is and not try and put too much time into it. Whereas, you know, I have all the respect in the world for the others. I've just been told that I'm going. So thank you, everybody. Thank
no
you,
worries,
viewers.
Mate. No worries. All right.
No, Patrick, you can't listen to the special comments. He's probably going to download this
Blackboard.
Later. Right.
Yeah.
Good night, folks.
See you, mate. All right. So, all right, mate. Seems like you get it done there, mate. Yeah. And Yeah, because a little bit unlucky there. Like he's doubled the doubled his dead red out, potted the one over the centre, and snookered himself behind the black, trying to get out of the snooker. It will now. Paul has some yellows to tidy up here for to make it a hill-hill match. And joining is the bloke that knocked me out in the last 16, and Mark Robertson. So well done on another win and another semi.
Ah, cheers, Hammer. Two very, very tough matches. I was actually. Oh, here we go.
Watching Robbo's replay of the black at 2-1.
I had to play with a bit of bottom right and kind of Massey off the cushion, half ball.
I was thinking the only reason you played that is because you couldn't tickle off the black and sit behind it.
No, that was.
You were going to go in off.
That was my plan. I was just trying to knock the yellow in before that and snooker behind the black.
Yep.
But that didn't go to plan, and I couldn't see. I tried to think of 10 different safety options, and I just couldn't see any that resulted in me actually winning the frame. So thought I'd have a crack.
Thought you'd pot it and then run two racks afterwards.
Yeah, it's always nice when that happens.
Why not?
I was just thinking during that match how I sent Susie a message saying I had you in the last 16 and got up 4-3 and it was a great match. It was a tough match, and as we were playing it, I just thought, man, I feel like you're making me work so hard to win my frames. And I felt Patrick did the same thing. I felt, geez, is it just me, or is, you know, these frames, is this really hard work? I'm sort of looking at the other tables and people are kind of missing balls and leaving easy outs, and I'm looking at the things I was able to do.
They're not all playing Robbo though, so when you are playing particularly a guy that's achieved pretty much everything, and also in this tournament only missed out on it once out of what, seven tournaments, so or six tournaments, so
this is the sixth.
You know, the bloke that's going to be coming up against you is going to be trying their asses off to knock you over. So
most people do the wrong thing and they try too hard in the wrong direction. They try to attack the game way too much and they overplay everything, try not to give me a shot. But if anyone kind of wants to learn some really good pool, I'd suggest watching mine and Nathan Harris's match. Just every shot I think we both played was the right shot and just made extremely difficult for your opponent. And guys normally go for outs against me and they chop them up, and I just walk to table snooker and get my two shots and pot out. But you and Pat both didn't do that. It was very difficult to win both those matches. This match here, 3-2 scary.
Yeah, and Brewer had a chance to really send that. They had two shots, and there weren't really a lot of tricky yellows on the table.
Oh, that's a bit stiff there.
And
has he got one or two?
Yeah, I think he only has the one.
Yep.
Yeah, I think Brewer had a double and missed it. And scary on those reds, but he had a chance to take that frame to a hill-hill match there. And
yeah, you got to take your chances.
Yeah.
You know, like
you do.
It makes pretty stiff to land Chinese there. If he doesn't land that bad, I'd probably back him to knock it in anywhere.
Yeah, and there's basically only one shot to play here, isn't there? So yeah.
Depends. You might be able to glance off it and leave it on the cushion, and hope Paul does something a little bit silly.
Put the black on the cushion.
You sort of weigh up what odds do you think you are of winning the frame or getting back in the frame by killing the black and sending the white up the table.
Coming off the cushion here and playing the black in the side.
Yeah. Against a player like Paul with the yellows in the positions they are, I'd say I'm maybe about a 1 in 5 to actually have a chance to win the frame if I play the black safe. And you're probably around the same odds to knock it in like that. You're probably around a 1 in 5.
Yeah.
So it just depends on how you feel, and you know, if you do miss that black, then I'll be able to walk and commentate. Ham, here we are. Can you still hear me?
Alright, so Paul once again has an opportunity to mop up, but he's it's been a little bit sus knocking these balls in. So he had a chance with two before. see how he fares here, but as I said, Paul should be backing himself in to make these. It should be no, and he's played a horrible shot there. But you know, it turns out that, well, now he's going to have to probably take the white off two or three cushions here to get back down the black, and didn't. He's just made an easy positional shot to get on the black, a little bit trickier. You know, it's just a careless shot, you know, ball over the hole. There should be no excuse for not landing on this one. You know, but it just shows you, you've got Robbo playing in the previous match, and he's got balls over the hole, and he's giving every shot the same amount of care, you know. And you get down here, and you watch a player. Yep, and he scratched it because of a loose shot, and it wasn't that shot. You can't say you're unlucky or anything like that. It's because one lazy shot on a yellow over the hole, and you get out of position on a simple ball, and it brings you into problems. Yeah, so yeah, you say that Paul's basically thrown away that match. Well, Paul's basically. Yeah, in a nutshell. So, yep. All right, so that leaves one more match to go in the last eight, and that'll be Butters and...
Is it two all over there?
Butters and Jamie Stevens, so... I might have to get another beer for that one.
You win there, Bretzky? Oh, you lost? Oh, I saw you knocking a bunch of blacks.
I missed one, but it can cost me victory.
Yeah. Jamo? Yeah, well, he's the Monday night league has certainly done him favours. He actually qualified sixth on the ladder, which may not sound fancy, but if you looked at the players who he finished ahead of, Paul Brewer and Chuka and Pikey and Steve Thomas, Dale Watson, you know, and a bunch of others. It was a good effort. The standard's very, very high in that. So, yeah, he'll play Michael Scarry tomorrow night, and Butters will play Kurt in the quarterfinals. Ooh, that's... I like that. If that yellow's not on, where... It's close to the red. I like that. If I'm Jamie, it just gives you another ball. You know, Pete can't just come off the cushion and whack this in or something like that. Don't be in a rush to win these frames. Scary distracting me there.
It is, yeah.
What's happened here?
Yeah. All right, so Butters has come out and kamikaze the red.
That's landed in a good spot.
All the way down there. And he's,
and, not left Jamie on or anything.
It'll be the nice little opener for Jamie. You can't see it.
This is a very good match between these two. Two very different styles. But at similar levels. You could learn a lot by watching these two. Just to see the different styles clashing. Now they're having a little chuckle.
Jesus, Jamie doesn't mind a bit of that mid-frame.
Jamie Stevens, the newly appointed captain of Victoria, as he should be.
Very good choice.
That's right. He's done Victoria proud many times at nationals and been a very been a bit of an anchorman up there. We tend to chuck him at number eight because, tell you what, when you're 12-11 up first to 13 against Western Australia or South Australia and everything's, oh, what a great shot. And everything's on the line. You want your anchorman, your last guy, to be someone who can fight out frames tooth and nail no matter what, play the right shots. And Jamie tends to do that, and he's won us a lot of matches up there. And it's not fun playing at number eight, always under that sort of pressure, but he's done it to himself. So be interesting to see where he actually gets to put himself this year.
He might relish it and put a bit more pressure on himself and play there. And I think mentally he's probably one of the toughest players certainly that I've come across or seen. So he'll back himself to winning from any position and in any frame. So it's a good teammate to have in your side.
That's right. You want someone who is just going to fight out every frame, not give up and try to play a hero shot. Yeah, I thought he might play this. So this is
unlucky there. Just
probably was always going to happen at that pace. Didn't want to hit it too hard though, in case it missed and left butters on the red. But I really like this Vic side going away to nationals. I think everyone will actually get along really well. No troublemakers in the side. You know, everyone likes to have a bit of a drink and a laugh every now and then, but none of them will go overboard. You know, I think that everyone who goes this year will definitely want to be there and not just going out of habit. So high hopes for Victoria.
Yeah, and the fact that there's a couple of guys like Nick, there's always another new face in Nick, and also myself hasn't been there for quite a few years now, so I can't speak for Nick, but I know I'm certainly hungry to go away, and particularly the guys that were there last year that went out in straight sets, so I'm sure they'll be keen as mustard to
definitely
get a taste of victory again. So
yep,
which is good for us.
I think every time we've lost it in the last 8 years or so, we've come back and won it the next year every time. I've just thought of that just then, so I may be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's the case.
Yeah, it'll be a nice stat to continue with. So
this is an interesting one here, Ham. What are you doing here? Are you glancing off and playing snooker? Are you attacking some sort of triple or?
Yeah, who knows with Butters?
I think the blacks are away.
I would glance off, but I guarantee you, Butters will do something different.
I don't like that shot at all.
No.
And that's you may think that's unlucky, but if you run that shot many times, for one, you've got to get the angle right, and you've got to get the pace right. The white's flying all over the joint. You know, you try and cover pocket normally, and it's difficult enough, let alone trying to do a thin nick face triple.
Yeah.
If this yellow's not on, that's actually a good result. I don't understand why you don't just play. You just glance off it and play the snooker.
And speaking of, and Jamie's probably screwed through a little too far there, but he's been a bit fortunate.
Yeah, just to pretty much get straight.
Yeah.
Just smack it straight in the corner.
Not sure he wanted to land there, but he'll take it.
Another 3-2.
3-2 to Captain Solid.
When you play a triple like Pete did, if you saw Pete's reaction, he felt like he was sort of, he played it well and was a bit unlucky. I'm telling you, you play that shot, you've done well if you can cover that pocket. You've done well.
Yeah. Yeah, it's basically only two. You're only going to be happy with two scenarios there, aren't you, with a shot like that? You know, either over the hole or in, and even if you do make it, where will you land on your next shot? You basically have no idea.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's...
Always make your opponent play one more shot. Always make them... That was actually a fantastic break. I don't know who broke the... Pete, that was about as a perfect textbook break as you can do. He stopped the white, great split, good control, the right amount of combination of power and timing. Yeah, just a little bit annoyed by last frame, I think. But if you watch the tennis and you watch Federer and Nadal and these guys, these greats, they always make, even when they're losing a rally, they always make their opponent just seem to play that one more shot. They always just somehow chip it back in and then all of a sudden the other guy's got to rush the net or something and will twitch and hit the net or, you know, maybe the opponent just hits it straight back and hits a winner. But they've made their opponent play one more shot. Don't just give up in a frame and try and basically play the shot that Pete did.
And when you repeatedly do it as well, like it's you can make an opponent play an extra shot here there, and but these guys, it's just a repetition for those guys to continually do it.
Yeah.
And when you're playing, particularly in the example you use of tennis, when you're playing someone, say in a Grand Slam, you might be out there for 3 or 4 hours. When you're constantly doing that to someone,
yeah, that's it. It grinds them down. It wears them out. They get frustrated. They're not making any frame easy for them. Like they're always annoyed that they have to constantly work for their frames. I didn't really see what situation Jamie was in before, but he had to play a double and it wasn't easy and he's missed it, and I'm kind of a bit... He's left Pete this out. Now, I didn't see really where the white was. Maybe he didn't have any options, or maybe he thought if he makes a double he can pot out himself or something, but
he's
still a bit tricky here.
He played it with played that double with a lot of pace to get the white back out in the centre of the table, but...
Won't be happy about that.
Worked out too well there.
No, he can only see about half this red over the pocket. Yeah, that's no good at all. You're probably just going to see him dolly up to this red over the pocket.
Yeah.
Oh, hang on. Is the double?
Yeah, I'm just thinking, does he have to straighten up too much and he might double kiss?
Hard to tell. He might be able to play the double and leave the white kind of where the red is and not really leave Jamie a shot.
Jamie
will only have the yellow up the rail. The black's blocking those three yellows. That's probably a shot. You remove that red off that cushion. It's in a bad spot.
You probably just chip it out and leave the white where the red is, as you say, if you can't double it.
Yeah, I think whatever you do here, just leave the white where that red is on the cushion and just bounce the red off if you have to. But Pete, I think Pete's very, very attacking, and it's getting him some success here and there, but probably a little bit inconsistent. Yeah, this is the right shot. He's desperately tried to think of a way to pot out here.
Yeah,
he's really, and he's a very, very creative player, so he would have been thinking all sorts of crazy shit. See what's happened.
Yeah,
that's the shot.
Just chipped it out.
And he's played it really well to block the yellow into the corner pocket between the two reds. See, now Jamie's looking at it now. That was really important. Maybe it won't be a factor, but maybe that will be a huge factor. So he's played that pretty much spot on, in my opinion. Now you're just trying to... Oh, hang on, he might be on this yellow in the middle, not sure. So what you need to do is here, you need to just try and contain the frame, just make it as hard for Pete as possible. Run the yellow down the rail to cover that pocket after this shot, after the next couple of shots.
Yeah, so he may look to maybe pinch a pocket down there. Who knows?
We'll see. If this yellow is on into the corner where Jamie just looked, he might be able to actually pot out from here. But if it's not on, then it changes everything. So you can see where Pete put that red. It's very important. It's pretty good turnout here today.
Yeah, I was just saying before that. I was just saying before to like whoever it was that was listening to me that it's been about 5 months, I think, since they had the last. You probably know because you've played in all of them. But
it was a bit before Anzac.
Oh, it was June, wasn't it?
It was a bit before Anzac. Yeah, I think it was probably about 2 or 3 months ago.
Yeah, I was just saying it was a bit scattered over the last 4 or 5 months because of state titles, Anzac, big guns.
Yeah, a lot of tournaments going on.
A lot of stuff going on. And
the standard here when they drew out the last 16, it was 8 quality matches. Mm.
This yellow must go inside
the red. Mm. I didn't even really think of that.
Really hard to tell from this angle.
He's got to be very sure about this.
The way I'm saying, you wouldn't play it if it wasn't a chance.
Yeah, he's a pretty calculated player here. He doesn't take unnecessary risks, so this must be a chance. Oh, wow.
Absolute clean in. So I think you'll now look for Jamie to double that yellow to his right, and that's what he's looking at now.
The thing was, he didn't land on a yellow. Like, even if that moved the red out of the way, which I didn't even know the yellow even went in there, he didn't. He just put everything into the pot. He didn't concentrate on the white.
Yeah, I think he just assumed that the even if he did make it, he had no shot on that yellow anyway. But
great
he's
shot.
He's played that a lot better.
Huge shot. That's the kind of thing Butters does to people all the time.
Yeah.
This is a very... Yeah, I've just had a look at it. This is an extremely tough shot. Queuing off the cushion's hard enough, but when you're queuing off the side of the cushion like this, it can be even harder.
Yeah.
And this pot is a lot thinner than what it looks. This is very tough. And you're dealing with rolls, and you don't know where the white's going to go to land on the black, so you're very, very, very tough. Back yourself and cue it in nicely. Play it at a pace that it can't roll, but not so hard that it just everything goes everywhere. Yeah, good pace.
And
I'm gonna chalk that up as unlucky. Mm. The white, yes, was always travelling in that direction, and it did go straight in off. But he's played that at a really nice pace. That if that just to come up and down for the black.
Yeah.
And it might have squared up off the cushion or something like that, but
you could play that shot another 5 or 10 times and you'll get a different result off potting it every time. So,
yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
He may have looked at that and thought, Jesus, white's probably going to come straight back and go in off, but sometimes you just got to go, well, I kind of hope it doesn't. Wow, he's played that so bad.
Yeah,
he's played that the only way he could to stuff this up. He's on it. Jamie just had a you on that. I actually thought he overheard me for a second, but he'd be the first person to admit how bad he played that. It's very, very lazy shot there. And this is just where sounds big headed or whatever, ego or something, but I feel like in these tournaments, I probably try harder than anyone else. I look around the room and I see people taking easy way outs or rushing or not really walk around the table. I think I walk around the table and look at everything more than everyone else. And it's not because I can just knock in a big ball here or there or play a nice little recovery shot or something. You know, you really have to try really, really hard to beat these guys. I mean, looking at, like, Butters is top 20 in the country right now. Jamie Stevens has been around forever, and you know, like a dozen statesides and everything. If you want to beat these players and not just turn up and happen to beat one of them once in the last 32 and then lose the next round, if you want to beat them multiple times in a row when the balls aren't running your way, then you have to try so hard every shot. If I'm Jamie, I'm very happy with that break, even though he didn't get a ball in.
Yeah,
of course, he wanted to get a ball in, but this style falls into Jamie's hands.
Yeah. It's a solid special.
Pete's probably going to have a go at the air. That black's definitely dead. See, I feel he's rushing this. He hasn't worked everything out. You know, he's just tried to pot that and extract that, and then what am I going to do? I'm going to run that one down the rail, and then... I'll tell you what, then what? See, I'm just going to double this and try and extract that. If I'm Jamie, I'm happy for him to extract that, and then he can pot that, and he can keep potting balls, and... What? The thing that... See, and now he's stopped. Now he's thinking. Why wasn't he thinking two or three shots ago? The thing... Peter's a fantastic player, but at any point there, if you quickly stopped him and you said, how are you putting out from here? He had no idea. And at 3-all in a quarterfinals. And that's why I'm saying, if you were Jamie, you wanted him to make that double and that extraction, because then he couldn't do that. Pete's actually very lucky. I'm a harsh critic on the top line players, because I expect a very, very high standard from them. So anytime they make mistakes, I pretty much pounce on them.
Yeah, I was just saying before, like even when like Paul, chopped up that out against Mickey, basically had two yellows over the hole and black down the
other end away. Of the table.
It was just a rush yellow because it was over the hole, just a rush, and just assumed that he would get and he got on that yellow, but he had to come instead of maybe one cushion, it now becomes two, maybe three cushions to get on the black, and of course because he's overhit it, because he's had to play a little bit more on the white, he's gone in off.
Yeah.
Whereas there was no in off because you can walk off and you go, I was unlucky, I went in off there, but it was the shot. It's the shot before generally that brings you undone. And it's because just a simple little duty of care on the simple shots. And I was saying before, that's why you have a look at, the last two outs you made against Patrick. There's basically three, four balls just sitting in the middle of the table, right? But you played them all like they were all on the rail, or you had to extract something or whatever. It's just, you give it the same duty of care, and that's why you have a better record than most in these things. So,
well, it's the simple shots, because if you play the simple shot well, guess what? Your next shot is simple, and if you keep doing that, every shot's easy. And some people get a buzz out of playing big recovery shots and all that sort of stuff. I can do that stuff too, but I don't get a buzz out of it. I get a thrill out of trying to play perfect. I get a thrill out of trying to play my matches with no mistakes. That's how I keep count in a match, is who's made more mistakes. Isn't that right, Brett? I'll be doing a bit of commentating with Brett tomorrow night on the two quarterfinals matches, Mick against Steve Thomas and Kurt against Butters. So it'll be very interesting. You get two different styles of thinking. Brett Rogers, believe it or not, is a very, very smart player. He's just simply too lazy to apply it. He honestly is. What's that?
You can't put brains in monuments.
Can't put brains in monuments. Well, that's why I mentioned the Australian Masters to Brett. And if Brett really wants to win it, he's going to be a big effort for people to stop him, but which Brett's going to turn up? Wow. I can't believe he's gone through that gap.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Well, look, it was no guarantee to land on it, but geez, I'm tipping he'd have a better shot than he does now. Yeah. That is unbelievable.
Yeah, he hit something.
And this is why I'm talking about these frames falling to Jamie's hands. I think Jamie's just hit a yellow twice and done absolutely nothing.
So obviously look at a thin nick off the yellow here and hope to yeah, just get perfect contact on it and knock it in.
Ooh.
And that'd be taken over, Brett. Solid.
Oh, I thought you won, Brett. Jammo, hey? The dangerous Jammo. Yeah, he's a bit more experienced. He's got the potting and he's got the creativity. When he gets the control and learns the percentages a bit better, he'll be a very dangerous player. Well, I cannot see Jamie losing this frame from here. I tell you what, he's probably just going to pot out right now, really. But if you are not certain of potting out from here, do not take it on. If you think you're a 90%, don't take it on. 90% is not good enough. Any shot that you think is ooh, and it could lose me the frame. See, he really wanted to bring the white back another sort of foot there so he can just roll this yellow in the middle and mop up the two next to the black.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm talking about with the... You know, he thought about it, but he didn't really actually think about it. And now look what he's having to do. This is where it gets a little bit funny. And a stun over. Yeah, that should be right. That's a good shot. But now he... One bad shot, if he just stuns it in an inch short or an inch too far, all of a sudden he's got a funny little cut, and he should be fine. He should make this, but should is not good enough here. See, if that just pulled up half an inch, all of a sudden he's got a half ball yellow off the cushion, when the white's on the cushion. Like I said, I'm being a bit harsh, but with Jamie playing butters, like I just expect to watch perfection. So when I don't see it, I'll pull him up on it. Yeah, very even match there, as you'd expect. All right, off to my semi-finals. Please don't be harsh, Brett.
Good luck. Joining on in the puzzler, Brett Rogers.
Accumulating microphones
and
will.
Yeah. Accumulating play by plays.
We've had some fitting pool here today. It's been quite entertaining.
Yeah, good field. Solid field. You know, if you win one of these, you've certainly earned it, that's for sure.
That's for sure. Amazing. So what do you think it'd be? Well, what's the odds of Skiri playing Robbo now?
Oh, I'd say about 500 to 1. Yeah, 500 to 1.
The Big Brother house.
Yeah. Money on a.
So we've got Jamie, Steve Jamison, Michael Skirry.
I'll call it now.
Mark Robson. Who's your pick, mate?
Well,
you got to go with Mark.
Look,
you
have to say Mark. You have to say Mark. I mean, well, I need a reason not to pick him. So,
yeah, that's true. But obviously the other three are very accomplished players, and Steve Jamison is improving out of sight of this game rapidly. I've just had a good match with him, and he capitalised on the opportunities given to him, and he actually made a massive out on me in the last frame after I missed a black, which you can't do in this game. But it was Jamie just said, he told me last night on Facebook that I would be commentating Jamie said to me I'll be commentating him in the final today. Well, he's not quite there yet, but he's not far away.
He's one match away.
We're about to find out what the matchups are. You'd have to say, personally, I rate Mark. I think probably most people, if they're going to be honest with themselves, would have to rate him in the top three players in the country.
No reason why you wouldn't put him certainly in the top five anyway.
If you mention any three names. I think Mark Robinson's name has to go in the mix.
Has to be in the conversation.
But definitely in the top five,
It's in the conversation,
We'd have to say he's got the...
As I said before, you need a reason not to have him there. And he hasn't given me one, so...
That's true, mate.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I don't think you'll be in Darwin with us this year because...
No. Fatherhood.
He's got a child on the way, Certainly, just his presence makes a big difference.
Yeah, but as we all know, Poole's never going anywhere.
No, Poole's not going anywhere. Mark's got another 40 years of this game going into play still.
If he wants to front up again in another 12 months, I'm sure Poole might still be around.
He might be making state sides in 2067 or something.
Yeah, so I'm glad I'm a bit older than him, so I can squeeze in a few Masters Guernseys before he gets there.
Yeah. Oh, it is Michael versus Mark, and Jamie versus Steve.
Oh, there we go. I just done my balls. Anyway.
All right.
400-1, someone should have got on.
I think it's been a while since Michael's actually beaten Mark in anything, out of memory. It's been a while since most people have beaten Mark in anything.
Look, if you asked Mark who he'd prefer to play in the semi, he'll probably say someone other than Mick, but he would know.
Yeah.
He would know. Both would know how good Robbo's record is against him, how dead.
No doubt, you'd have to say Steve's got the less experience in the game out of the four players.
Yeah.
But he's potting very well, and his pop position's very good at the moment.
And I think Jamie and Steve would be very happy with who they've drawn each other. Yeah. So.
But in saying that, probably Steve was probably, well, I don't know, next to Mark, it's a touch and go, would be the best snooker player in the field, so Steve was a very accomplished snooker player, Here we go.
And hates a drink.
Yeah, he hates a drink, he's got a drink in his hand.
Yeah.
He just broke off Steve, and good break. He's got a red ball. And a yellow, no, red, just a red.
And I think for JMO to basically... To beat Jamie, I think he needs
We'll see. Basically, this is a very good test for Steve because Jamie will play his game. So the bottom line is we're going to see what Steve counteracts what Jamie does, we'll see how far he has come in the game.
Yeah, that's right.
If the balls aren't spread like this, of course. This is an out you would expect Steve to get.
Yep.
But there's no guarantees in the game, that's for sure.
Yeah. And certainly, a semi to get into a final of any tournament, you want to start off well. When you break and you get this kind of a layout,
you
made the semi. You're obviously playing well. You back yourself in to finish these off. And as you say though, it's one thing can go wrong and.
Yeah.
You're under the pump.
And Jamie's hard to beat, I've found over the years. And Jamie's hard to beat, doesn't matter how he's playing.
Oh, and he's just screwed back
he's
to...
He's played...
He's screwed
he
back
may
to
have got
there.
Lucky here. He may be on this ball into the middle.
Yeah.
But, he's overhit that by a mile.
Bit of a rush of blood there, but, you know.
A bit uncanny for the way he's been playing, actually.
and Jamie will be loving this, like basically get blokes to hang themselves early and Jamie will be like, thank you, I'll just I'll play this shot here, tie you up here,
do what he does.
That's why I call him solid.
That fell in.
Yeah. Not a bad opener there by Jamie.
Very good shot.
Yeah. There's a shot to nothing there, so basically, got coverage on the black, but drops, opens up the frame for him.
Actually, these tables are funny in a sense like that. Sometimes you think, you hit a ball pure and it doesn't go in, and then you don't hit a ball, you think, there's not much chance of popping this, and it just flies in the pocket. They're a bit strange like that.
Yeah. He's landed exactly where he finished.
Well, Xavier, that Jamie a bit, but
he's landed exactly
right.
Where he finished before. Maybe able to play a little bit of screw into this red. If it passes that yellow, I'm not too sure. Yeah, I think it does go.
It does go, but yeah. He's actually got us. Oh, he's actually playing the plant.
Yes,
red onto the red. Okay. Try to get them both over the hole. Oh, wow. Went pretty easy, actually.
Yeah, very easily. And he's got the perfect angle here, the squeeze between red and black here. And it basically presents him with both balls.
I think you can pot this ball.
Yeah, that's what I mean. You can. And then we're landing between the red,
right,
and, red and the black.
That's right, yeah. It looks like. Pretty natural.
You can have the option of the red in the centre or the black in the corner. Red in the corner. Probably take the red in the corner first, I'd say. Where's he going here?
Playing a double. Fair enough, I suppose. He's got it.
And that's thrown. It looked like it did skid, but
yeah.
A good hit by Jamie.
All he's got to do is get into the middle of the table here, and it's pretty basic, obviously. He's under hit it. Oh, he's still on it.
Yeah.
I think he meant to go past the yellow there, Nate.
Yeah.
You wouldn't want to really
No, because he's probably going to play into this yellow now.
That's right.
Either that or he can screw over it and
I think you've got to actually I'm not sure if he can miss the yellow. He may be able to. He can miss the yellow.
Yeah, he's playing with a bit of bottom here and land in the middle of the table. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, he can miss it easy. No, he's fine.
So Jamie's sending an early message here saying if you miss, I hit.
One little to Jamie.
Yeah.
What's going on with Mark and Michael?
Right, so
obviously you can see Mark's at the table. It's a lovely shot.
Yeah.
Perfect shot.
Yeah.
And he's got a perfect angle to get on the red and balk now. Off this, it looks like it anyway. Maybe a touch.
Yeah, looks like a little straight. Just thinking he may take this red and bring the white across the table and try and get angled the other way, because the red definitely does squeeze inside that yellow.
Yeah, he must be straight on if he's playing it.
Yeah.
Well, that's fine, yep.
And I think he might be straight again.
Oh, he's a bit close to the cushion. That's restrict his cueing a bit.
Yeah. Wouldn't matter so much if he had angle, but I don't think he has the angle here.
I thought a bit strange that Mark's actually left this red to last, because pretty big shot when we're out to get on the black.
Yeah, it was just all because he was.
But he's been
on
the table.
Straight on the other one.
Yeah, well, he knows the table, so. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Well, Well, I think he's too straight on this. Turn eighth. Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Plenty of no angle, as Pixie would say.
Yeah. Yeah. Pixie knows all about this. Yeah, yeah. He just creates an angle, though.
He does.
Accumulating angles at will. He's forced into playing a double there. And you have to say Michael's firm favourite to win this frame.
Vintage yellow, you would say. And I think Mick would have to win this frame. You know, to get early frames on the board against
Robert. You just can't let good players off in these situations, can you?
So you don't want Mark getting out. You know, Mark's one of the better front runners going around. If he gets ahead of steam up,
absolutely
1-0, 2-0. It's basically he might not get a look in.
Mark doesn't care how long it takes him to win. He'll just grind you into the ground.
Yeah, put him under pressure early.
He's got a bit of a tricky shot here. It's not a musket, but shot from Michael. And I think Michael should take the one in the left hand centre pocket here and just bounce out.
Get some angle.
Just create an angle on the ball that's below the cluster.
Yep. Yep.
Not the one that's closest to the hole, but the ball that's higher. Yeah. And just disturb those other two yellows into place.
Yeah.
Which is what he's doing, I would say. But the key here is to make sure you get the ball that he's going to pop now. Get the one just above that. Make sure it's not stuck to the cushion. You must get that ball out in the open. And he may be a bit thin on this to do that.
Well, I was just thinking you could roll this yellow in still, and if you're too straight, you roll this in and then basically.
He's looked for that angle again. He's fine now.
Yeah. I don't mind just rolling that in, actually, and then you could play that yellow.
You need
corner.
To get that ball away from the centre off the rail length, you need to actually split these balls a bit and get a bit of space. Like that. Oh, he's missed it. There you go.
I just thought going that way, you said you're guaranteed to have angle to, and you didn't have to play it as aggressive like that, but anyway.
I think we wouldn't see Mick miss that pot very often.
No, you wouldn't.
So he's obviously taking his eye off the ball there. Mm-hmm. That's not pressure, that's just not putting it on the shot 100%. Mm-hmm. People think that, I think a lot of people seem to think that's pressure, but it's not. Geez. It's not the good players. That's not pressure, it's just that's slack, actually.
Yeah.
That's all we've got.
We've been talking about that a bit before, about just lack of care on a few shots and costing people frames on just simple shots. And it's usually the simple shots that bring you undone.
That's
you just assume you'll get the result you want out of it. Anyone can concentrate on the hard shots.
That's right. All of a sudden you find yourself in a 90-10 position to 90-10 the other way, Nathan. And you think to yourself, why have I done this?
And we've all done it too. You might have to, put a few snookers on, you might have to tie up balls, things like that. You do whatever you do for 20 minutes and finally you get the opening that you want. Because of all the 20 odd minutes of,
That's
boobers that you've put in.
Yep.
and you get to the finish line and then you throw it away.
Yeah.
Yep. All done.
We've had another frame finish on the Jamison Jamie table. What happened there?
I didn't see there.
Pete, who won the last one with Steve and Jamie?
Wow.
Jamo won.
And Mick
that's
is
one
just,
all now with
Mick
Stephen and Jamie and Gemma.
An absolute sitter into the corner there.
Oh my God.
Now I know what you're saying about it's just slack and everything like that, but
Maybe a bit of pressure on
I
that one.
I guarantee you.
It was mid-range table shot, was it?
Well, put it this way. If I'm playing Mick, that's going in 100 times out of 100, right?
The Robbo factor.
He doesn't... I don't scar Mick like this bloke does. So.
Mark's good seems to have that effect on a lot of people.
Does have a bit of factor about him, that's for sure.
Yeah, certainly has. Yep. Certainly got his presence about him,
yep,
right?
Yeah. Cheers, mate. Thanks.
Cheers, buddy.
But yeah, look, you know, I think that can get in your head big time. But yeah, that was just basically just a straight roll through and...
Was it?
And yeah. Just a straight roll the yellow down and knock the black in. Well, Nick's got no shot here, but I guarantee you, he's got a shot. So... You'd be happy with that.
Yes. Mm. What do you do here, Nath?
Well, do you just bump it out?
I think you've got to bump it just past the red if you can and get the white hard up on the top rail. Mm. That's the ideal situation, but whether he can do that, he should be able to
I think
do that.
He's going to do that. Just
more close, control of the whitey, but you don't want to leave the yellow dead down in the rail. Something like that. That's a pretty good shot. Well, it's a bit hard. That's not bad, though. You'll cop that. Mm. Mark's got to play a good shot here. Mm. Well, bringing the ball into the middle of the table, no matter where Mark leaves the white now, gives Mick options. So, if he had left the yellow near the top rail, he obviously, there's no advantage. So, he's made Mark have to come up with something pretty good here. It's a great shot.
It's a cracker.
It's a very good shot. This is no gimme. You expect him to knock it in, but it's still no gimme. Good shot. So, 1-1 to Mark Robinson and Jamie Stevens and Steve Jamison. 1-0 to Mark Robinson and Jamie and Steve are 1-1. And here we go.
Yep.
Here comes Jamie's sleeper hole.
These are the solid specials.
The way Gemmo pots and plays position, though, and he will have a go here. He knows he has to have a go. If he gets this double, he is certainly a chance to get these balls.
He's got that insurance with the yellow down the bottom there. He knows that
great
he can,
shot.
Yeah, he knows
that's a great
that he
shot.
Can bump both balls out there. And
he's put the onus back on Jamie there. That was a very good shot.
Now, does the red, one of those bottom reds, those little reds next to one another, does one of them pass down the yellow on the top right hand corner?
I think they both do, Nath, but I think he has to. I don't think he'd be playing that now and try to cover the hole because this yellow, the bottom yellow, will go inside this red. So
now that red might go, that red that's down,
I
that
think
pocket might go in anyway, so it might go through, pass through anyway, so he might not need to.
Yeah, I think Jamie had to take that first. Mm. Actually, if he had got up a bit higher, he would have had a nice angle just to screw up and get on the ball and balk. And then float his way down the table. So, that's probably what he had in his mind here. Now it's different because the angle's not there to get on the red. Always going to be dodgy there.
He's got a shot in the corner here.
He's got a shot on the one in the middle too. He's on the one in the middle, so. But now he's brought this yellow out. Maybe the red doesn't look like a pass in the top right hand kick there, so.
Yeah, he's probably made that red knot on now.
Actually, you're right. It goes in the corner, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it does go in the corner. The ball in balk.
It's just getting the angle for this one down here, so.
Yeah, well, he's got two problem balls now, not just one. This is it's a must get, you'd have to say, wouldn't you, Nath?
I'd say so, mate. Yep.
And he's knocked it in. That's a beautiful shot.
Great shot.
Now, does it pass? We're about to find out.
Yeah.
We'll know by the positional shot here.
I would say no, but it wouldn't be the first time I've got a call wrong from here.
Well, Jamie knocked in a ball over there to a quarter of a pocket. I was standing behind when he was playing Peter. And everyone just stood there in amazement thinking, how did that go in? I went in clean, so it was just amazing. But obviously the way Jamie plays will determine whether his red goes or not.
Yeah, I think he might be looking to play.
He looks like he is trying to stun it.
I reckon he's
going to
play the red in the same pocket.
Yeah,
just didn't get through enough.
Yeah.
But he's got the double on here, so that's good.
He has too.
Yeah. So he didn't get where he wanted, but he still
could
has
be
a
worse
shot.
Though, couldn't it?
Well, it's just a matter of running through here, and he's basically,
yeah, he's
if it
on the black,
drops
just
it,
goes
he's
in.
Black in the centre.
That looks pretty good for me.
No,
he hasn't hit it. That's the only problem. Mm. That was definitely in the hole, but now, can Jimmy get inside there?
Yeah, I wouldn't be a fan of that if I was Jamie. It's just not in enough.
What's happening in the mortal? No, Michael's on reds.
Yeah. We'll go back to that after this frame. And look at that roll in. Like that was all day long rolling, going past the jaw there.
What happened?
He screwed back into the side rail, yeah. and I swear it was going past the side,
okay.
And it's just drifted in.
You've got a bad roll.
Yeah. I guarantee you that wasn't going in.
Mm.
And Solid will pick up a strawberry there.
Yeah. Jesus, Michael's sort of...
He's feeling the, I think he's feeling the pressure a bit here.
Yeah, he hasn't beaten Mark for quite a while, has he? So
no.
I don't even know if he ever has beaten him in Taunton, to be honest. So.
He has sucked out on him in a few poker games, but at home. But I don't know if but I don't know him pulled though. Yeah.
Well, it's now at 2-1 to Jamie. And depending on a couple of shots, it's either going to be 2-love or 1-all with Michael and Mark. So, playing a lot of time here, Mick. I think you have to play the ball in balk, don't you, Nate?
Well, I would have thought so.
Come into the middle of the table and clear up that end. He's got to try and go out.
Yeah.
So
the thing is, I don't like this shot, the fact that if he pots it,
he's
got nothing.
He's got the same shot that he was just on.
Yeah.
Well, he hasn't even got
that.
Yeah. And why hasn't got through? That's a weird shot.
Yeah. It's only a great shot if it sits over well.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well,
he's probably fortunate that he can just squeeze through there. I think Mickey had his time back, he probably wouldn't play that.
It's a very strange shot selection.
Yeah.
Jamie looks like he's got a pretty open table there.
I'd like to make a special mention to Lee Gilpin, $4.50 drafties, mate. You'd be pretty filthy, you're not here.
Well, Rob will take all the time in the world here. You'll make sure he gets these balls, you would.
Yeah, that's right. That's what I've said this a few times already, that, said it won't matter to him how easy the balls are or how easy the ball, like, people will be going, like, why is he taking so long and balls are just, why don't you just go and knock him in?
Mm.
But, this is why he wins and other people don't.
This is very true.
Yeah.
Very true. He's actually going to knock the blackie out of here, so...
Yep.
A bit stiff to land there. It's, any other contact, he's actually off the cushion there, and the black's out in the open, so... I mean, he's still going... You know, all the percentages are in his favour to play that shot, but... He's actually got the worst result from that shot.
Yeah. Yep.
Not that it should stop him, but...
Got too good contact on the black there.
I mean, he's only going to pot this ball, and then he's it's flat on the ball in the middle,
it's
so...
where you roll three balls in, basically, so...
Strange shot selection from Mick.
Yeah.
Very strange shot selection.
And again, it's just down to the pressure. That's you know, we all seen a lot of Mick and everything like that, and know what he's capable of. He just plays a different game when he's playing this bloke.
Gemmo's at the table on yellows by the looks of it. Deep screw off two rails, mate.
Nice.
Side rail and the other side rail. Just sit over there. Oh, you had that in. Oh, okay.
And he might have...
That looks all right. I play this with left-hand side now and just float the white back out in the middle of the table. Mm. That's a great shot. Control that really well.
Yep. Couldn't have picked up the white and put it anywhere better.
Very well controlled, that shot. And hit that very nice. Yeah. It's queuing well, Steve.
Yep.
Obviously, Michael broke and come up dry.
Mm. So Mick should be two up here. That two should be on the top of the score there, at the bottom.
Yeah, I agree, mate.
He's definitely had some chances. And,
I think it's going to be three now.
As I say, you only get the run of the balls for so long, and eventually they will turn.
You can't play top line players by giving them frames, can you?
No.
When you've got to beat, you have to beat them. Yeah. You're not going to get many more chances.
No. And if you do get them, you're fortunate. So. What's the
verdict, boys? We won't watch.
Hang on. What happened there? Do you want to know if it's a foul break?
It's only on the little screen, though.
So we're just going to our video review here. Looking for just a check on the foul break here.
One, two, three. That was only three. Can we do it again, Dan?
I thought it was fine.
If those two hit, it is four.
Just check it again. So, yeah. One, two, three.
Fair break.
That's fine. Solid not happy with the call, but I guarantee that was better than any AFL review that's been given this year.
It's all right. The Swans and the Hawks will be in the final, mate.
That's all I care about.
I think Velo might have other ideas.
Yeah.
Now, if Mark makes this plant, we'll know by the pace that he hits it whether he's actually going for it. Yeah, he's definitely going for it. He was going for it. Pretty good, not a bad opportunity here for Michael, even though.
Yeah. But he's just got to dust himself off now and just go, you know what, forget about those couple of frames that I've thrown away.
That's it.
I've got another chance here. Make the most of it. And he's overhit that by an absolute mile.
He's tried to knock that ball out now. I don't think he didn't have the correct angle to do that, mate.
No.
So,
but
he's certainly...
he's been very fortunate there.
Yeah, he has.
Clipped the jaw. I'm really not sure what he was trying to do there.
Really should have been just playing on that ball and knock it in, then put this ball off the yellow, eh?
Yeah.
But he's still at the table and certainly
still in a good position to
To take the frame.
To win the frame, yeah. Sometimes you need a little bit of a lucky roll here and there to, turn the tables in your favour. But you still got to, but you still got to take advantage of that. So,
we'll see whether he does. Obviously, Mark feeling too good because he knows he should have won the first two. He has to win this frame, obviously.
Yeah, exactly, mate. He's 3-0 down. It's almost impossible, but 2-0 down, it's still. Still a chance. Okay, this is frame ball coming up right here.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, because the yellow will get released from the pocket.
Yeah.
If he stuns us and he's on the ball in the middle, pots the other end of the top right hand corner.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
perfect. And that's worked out. Yeah. Could not have worked out better. So I guarantee you win. You pick up this frame, all of a sudden you start to forget about the other ones, and you
that might have rolled a touch. That.
Yeah. Still fine.
Could have got through that a bit more, Mick. Actually.
Yeah, he could have. Yeah.
You'd rather be a touch straighter on these than.
Don't want to be stretching.
Oh, he's fine. There's big pocket, plenty of pocket there. All right. Now, so we're 2-1.
All right.
2-1 and 2-2.
And here we have another solid special off the disputed foul break.
And Jammo's having a cracky.
He might just look to cover up here. Yep. Not a bad
shot. The tactical genius of Steve Jammo's is starting to come to the fore.
Not a bad shot. Yeah, just got to work on his coverage, but yeah. But yeah, that was a good shot.
He covers holes like me. Uncovered.
Covers it. He doesn't cover them like me. Normally they go in.
Well, you have to say that Gemma's favourite in this frame, Nate. Without any doubt.
You would. Yep, with both pockets covered.
If he releases Jamo, that red out of there now, he's certainly favourite.
Yeah, might have a dip at just... bumping them out here.
Yeah.
I reckon.
Yeah, I think it's... Can't be any damage.
Yep. No, he didn't.
He didn't.
And, well, lucky that... It was lucky he got a... See, the white made its way to the rail there. It's almost two shots.
I think he's trying to make sure that Jamie doesn't get control of one of the holes, because then Jamie can start to weave his... Weave his magic.
Do what he does. Do that thing you do.
Yeah. Well, here's a great chance for Gemma here.
Yeah.
Red onto red.
Yeah.
And release the other red in the pack and the black at the same time.
Yeah, he'd definitely be fancying himself here. And...
Don't play this hard though, obviously. He's not playing the shot. He's not going to.
I'm surprised.
Very surprised you play that shot.
He's playing a little too tactical now. Solid one mind.
He's got solid control of the frame, hasn't he?
Yeah, but solid one mind that. That's another red in the pack, so.
Yeah.
And now he's going to look to get one of those pockets. Yeah, that really surprised me, that.
I suppose if he does get the pocket, those but Gemma can just blast those three balls up the table a bit, mate. Like now. I think they're all coming out, but where they land is the problem. The shot before was probably the one.
As I said, he had a controlled shot before. Now he doesn't. He's a foul snooker, is it? Yeah, so he can't see the bottom red.
Of course, definitely,
Yep.
Well, that's why Jamie just shook his head straight away.
Yeah, he just didn't roll through enough. Yeah.
Well, that's made a huge difference. Screw into the bunch here. Great shot, Steve Jamison.
That's a cracker. That's a great shot.
He's He's a good proposition player, no doubt about it.
Yeah.
He's made numerous 140 breaks, so he knows what he's doing. He's certainly got a passion for the game of 8-ball.
You have to, mate, to be running these things.
Yeah. Someone just banged the table.
Yeah, and it wasn't Mick.
Mark.
It was Mark, yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
So you know when you're in a, when you're playing a guy that, and they're doing that, you know pretty much that you're a good chance to beat them, no matter who they are.
You've seen a lot of blokes over the years do that, though, Nathan. They don't get beat for some reason.
Just a few. Yeah, they probably fear for their life.
Maybe I should start doing it. I've never been one to do that, but maybe you should start doing it. I start winning the match here with me. Good shot by Jimmy.
Yeah.
This one in the middle. Then it's just stun, isn't it?
Yeah, he's
got two shots too, hasn't he?
Yeah. I haven't really lost the plot in the tournament yet, so
no, well,
thinking
like,
I might have to do that.
You're not that kind of person.
So
mate,
I can join.
You don't sit there and bang tables and
so
carry on.
So I can join Timmy's team, you know?
You play your game, you win, you lose, you take it as it comes, mate, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe you should do.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe we should both start bashing tables when we miss a ball.
All right, nice out there.
Jimmy Placella just joined us in the commentary box here.
Hello, mate.
3-2 to Steve Jemison. I tell you what, he potted a monster black on me to beat me. I don't know if you've seen the frame. You were in the commentary, I think, mate. He's made a massive hit on the black.
I saw the black that he knocked in. Well, we were all we couldn't figure out why, because it's a 3-2 on the score.
Yeah.
And there was no handshake when he knocked it in.
I knew he was 4. Then he's like, racking up the
okay,
ball.
Okay, what are they? What's going on? We got the score wrong or something? Yeah. But yeah, that was a bit monster black, that one. Yeah.
Then he told me he didn't know what the score was.
Maybe you should have told him before he got on the black that he was 3-2 up. He might have chopped it up.
That's what he said to me.
Yeah.
If I'd have known was this, the winner, I would have missed it.
definitely should have let him know.
It was a cracker
of a black.
Just
a friendly reminder.
A cracker of a black.
Yeah. By the way, if you make this, you win. I think Scary's got his tail up now. Maybe feeling a lot better than what he was 2 frames ago.
So Mark missed a pretty easy ball, did he?
No, I didn't really see.
He banged the table. It must have been too hard.
Yeah. And. Look for one of these blokes to take a toilet break very soon. And there it is. Oh, no, it's not off. No, he's just won 2 frames in a row, so he actually must legitimately want to go. Yeah.
Jamie's...
Definitely a favourite to send this to 3-all.
Definitely.
It's not a bad shot, that. Shot by Solid there. So he's just got the nice angle to just pop this yellow and just nudge the red out. And he's hit it too thin. But still not a bad result.
This would be a very good out if Steve can manufacture this, but... pretty hard to see where it's going to come from.
Yeah.
one thing for sure. There'll probably be a double involved in it.
I'd say more, maybe more than one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Clean pot. Very clean.
Okay.
Pot. It's going to cover the hole.
Yeah, I'd say so. I'd say so. If it drops, well, he's still got options. So yeah, but as you say, it'll probably come to a double at some stage.
Tricky shot to control this one though.
Yeah.
You can't leave the gap.
No. No. It's not too bad.
Not too bad. Yeah.
Yeah, it's not too bad. I didn't know if he was going down to play that for a second there. I thought he was just lining that up.
He's actually stopped Jamie from swerving around this, hasn't he? Can't swerve.
He will have to come off. He will have to come off the rail here, and just he probably just look to roll into this.
Yep. This year.
It's probably blocked any double off now.
Obviously, Steve will play in a retaining safety again here. How about doubling this ball here? The furthest one in Bork, closest to Bork, back into the top right-hand pocket and leave the wide arc on the top rail.
Hmm. Yeah, I don't mind that.
And he's not doing that.
Yeah, Steve's got other ideas.
Oh, he's obviously tried to get on that and push this over the hole, maybe.
Yeah.
Surely he's not going to try to take the left-hand top pocket here.
Yeah, I think your way may have been a better go there. Cause you said you're taking your pop balls up there. You're taking away a lot of your options.
Mm.
Now he's probably got no choice. It's to probably just
the one on the rail.
Yeah,
the hole.
Yeah.
I just hope Jamie doesn't go out.
Yeah. Yeah.
This goes in. Look at it roll.
Yeah.
It rolled a mile.
Yeah.
I copped a bad roll on that table.
Mm. Yeah, so again, it's probably come down to that double. But this has got to be executed perfectly.
Jesus.
Yeah.
That's a good shot.
It's actually worked out quite well.
Quite a good shot, isn't it?
You know Solid won't be taking the one over the hole.
No. What's mark on, yellow or red, can you tell?
Oh.
There's a red over the hole. Mark's on red. Okay. Jamie taking the pot on here, trying to screw into the rip.
I think so.
No.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Wow.
That's very interesting.
Steve, definite chance here, but if he does take the option to take the AA on, he has to get it, obviously.
Mm.
How about screw off the one, and that's up near ball, can get the cross double on the other one on the left-hand side rail.
Yeah, that's
out of the rip. Play it now, but it doesn't look to me like he's got the angle to play it. I'm like, no, he didn't.
That yellow mustn't go. That yellow. Well, why would you play that if it?
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah,
that's very true.
Yeah,
I think you're right. Mm. Yeah, didn't look like Steve had a look at that though.
No, it's just saying you wouldn't chip that out if that yellow didn't go. Sure, I mean if that yellow went.
Mm.
Jamie, all he needs to really do is just play the one over the corner and just knock it into that black.
Yeah.
Really much.
Just chip the black.
Yeah. No, he's obviously, he might be able to squeeze under the red here.
He's got a result.
That's worked out
okay. He's definitely got a result, hasn't he?
Yep.
And Gemmo put the red back in front of the yellow now.
Oh, that's unlikely. I would maybe double the red down the bottom and at the top of the table. Double it inside.
That's so good.
Doesn't.
That's a pretty good shot.
Yeah, that's. It's not too bad either.
Mm,
it's a great
very
shot.
Good shot.
Definitely out thinking, Jamie, at the moment. So yeah, this is not easy to do.
Come on, girl.
Oh yeah, here we go.
Two shots.
I don't know if I'm really thrilled with that. Sony could just bump this out and then put it over the hole.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Get the red into the open and just put the other red, red over the hole.
Yeah.
And trying to do you up and down the table, no? Oh, Steve, a bit lucky there.
Yeah, yeah.
Certainly
and
wasn't where
exactly
he's
going
to
do. Put this over the hole. Yep. Not too bad though. Not too bad.
Knocking the red across.
Yeah.
Knocking the red across.
Oh.
Black.
Oh.
Good shot.
Yeah. Very nice.
I think.
Yes,
he could have gone game there if it actually.
Yeah. Well, I assume
yellow,
that. I assume
no,
that yellow
doesn't go underneath.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
But he's going to chip. He could go into it, couldn't he?
He could have. He had the angle too. Yeah. Absolutely. It looked fine, but we'll check it again if you want.
I'm pretty sure it hit the
yellow. I thought it was fine, but we'll check it again.
I'll tell you what. Can we get a slow motion, Dan?
Yeah. Well, that actually.
It actually. Hang on.
Hey,
hang on.
Hang on a second.
It might be a foul, Jamie. Hang on.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're gonna have a look at that again. I reckon he has hit the red first.
I think he has. Yeah.
Oh, it's the red.
Yeah, he has.
Yeah, it's a foul. Foul.
It's a foul.
You
hit
the red.
Yeah. He'd be wrapped that he hasn't potted the yellow now.
Yeah. Fucking Jimmo's got eyes like a hawk.
Yeah. Clearly hasn't had enough to drink.
Mark's just gone 3-2 up over there.
Yeah. And I clearly have had too many. That's not a bad shot. Yeah, that's not a bad
certainly
shot.
Certainly learning this game of pool, isn't he?
He is, yep. And you'll probably find that Jamie just glances off that bottom yellow just to promote it.
Yeah, and then
knock it in the same pocket.
Yep.
And
but once again, he's got to
work out a way to.
Ideally, he'd be looking for an angle so he could screw into the yellow, release those two balls, and try to go game here because. Well, he could just bring it out here and play it with a bit of side and release it now, Nate. Like that.
That's a great shot. Yeah.
That was an option.
Yep. Well thought out that.
It's obviously a lot tighter than what we think it is. Otherwise, it'd be a soft stun. Put the other yellow on the up, in the right hand.
I thought it was just roll yellow in corner, roll yellow in centre. Yeah. Well, I still think that's what will happen, but.
Yeah, plenty of room.
Drive a truck.
Yeah. All right, one good pot from Jamie, it's real.
Yep.
This is
cross over to the Robbo Scary match after this. And
got it.
Yeah, good hit.
3-all. The end of the wire.
All right. Okay.
Marks on yellow by Wilson.
I'd say so. Yeah.
Well, this is a perfect angle to get into the gap here, isn't it? Release them all.
Yeah.
Perfect angle. Oh, a little bit. He's still on the ball here, but a little bit unfortunate there, actually. That was an ideal angle. Well, I don't think we'll see Mark make any mistake here, though.
No, you wouldn't think so. But, you know, as we all know, I have been made to look silly before.
Pot this one in the middle. Pop the other one in the middle, lean straight on the ball over the pocket of the screw back and get on the ball.
Yeah.
That's what he's thinking here.
Yes. So what did the pay down to today? You know? Is it top eight?
Yeah, I think so.
Top eight? Yeah.
I got $50, so.
I got on the bubble.
You on the bubble?
I'm on the bubble. Yeah. Yeah, missed out on $5.
I nearly got extra frames. I would have had to tell him. I knew it was over. Please pull on the ball. I said, Yamo, what are you doing?
Alright, so just it's just all about white ball here.
Maybe he has to run through this.
Yeah, I'm just thinking like he's not straight on
exactly
this, is he?
Where he wants to be on this.
Yeah. He's not dead straight on this, is he? Might need to. Yeah, looking at running through and playing the yellow into the middle, and then if you get the angle on that, you're basically perfect on the black. But he's checked it nicely.
Played it with check side. Yeah. Very good shot. Now here, he's got to miss the red above the yellow and stun into the other one. Full ball contact. He was dead straight. Couldn't screw back. Yeah, we played with check side, yeah. Mm. Obviously couldn't screw back, if he had to play with check side. This is a stun up past the red, hit the other red. But in doing that, you have to miss the red that's directly above the yellow. Or is he going to go higher, back off the rail and back out in the middle of the table? That's what it looks like he's playing, though. Screwing back off this.
Yeah.
He's fine. Yeah. Played it well.
Yeah, that's perfect. Yeah, it's better than playing a little stun shot and possibly
wrong.
Sitting behind the black.
That's
and,
true.
You know,
could go
you
wrong
can really there. Dig into the white more than that way. So, yeah, good response by Robbo there. And I'm going to say something that hasn't been said in a while. Mark Robertson's in the final. whether you got a kick
James
on that or whether
that
was just horrible, I don't know.
Wow. Yeah. Steve's definitely a chance here. That middle ball in the pack looked like it is on into the top right-hand pocket. that's really the key ball for mine, Ian, if that is on.
Yeah, I think so. I think you're right.
Got to be careful he doesn't knock yellow in the pocket.
Yeah, true. He's probably wary of it a bit too.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's not a bad result though. Yeah. Mm. Jamie's under the pump here. I think he just basically has to cover the hole here. I don't really know what else there is to do.
Play the double and screw the end of the side rail and pump the yellow up the top.
Yeah, well, it looks like he's going to play a double here. Yeah.
He's done him a lot of favours.
He's very fortunate that he got contact with the black on the red there, because that the black at that pace was heading over, not say it was going to go in, but certainly heading toward over the hole at least. And that would have he would have been in a world of hurt if that had happened. I think he's still anyway.
I think Steve wins if he knocks us in, mate.
I'd certainly like to be on reds.
He's got a great pot. Very good potter, isn't he? He is.
Yep. Never played Steve, so like he's obviously been playing a few tournaments and things like that, but I've never even played one frame against him.
Well,
but he's
compared to, you know, 12 months ago, you know, he's a much better pool player now, obviously. Oh.
Yeah, good.
Well, he's played it well. He's learning the game. Getting used to all
the nuances.
Yeah. He knows where the little white's going now, so.
It's half the battle. Because all these guys that come over from like snooker and other forms of Q sports and things like that, they always say the same thing. It's always the smaller white that gets him. It brings him unstuck. So, you don't forget the shots or tactics and things like that. I mean, tactics can be picked up and stuff, but it's the, you know, on open frames and everything like that, you know, it's always the white that you lose, you know, because it's smaller and, you know, springs around a little bit more.
You put the red onto the ready and bring the black out, you know? I think you have to, don't you? You don't leave the black there for and give Jamie the opportunity to put it onto the yellow.
No.
As long as Steve gets the black out of here, he's certainly in the driver's seat.
Well, you could probably play two shots.
Just bring them both out.
Yeah.
Sometimes you just play shit. That's all right, mate. The Robinson factor was there, like it usually is.
Yeah.
We thought we were mean, Nathan, saying we thought Michael played a couple of uncharacteristic shots there, but tends to happen when people are playing you. The long pot that he missed, well, it wasn't a long pot, I didn't see it.
The yellow he missed to get on the black, and I was just like...
And when he came off the rail, remember when he had the ball over the hole and he knocked it in and he snooked it himself?
Yeah,
very uncharacteristic shot from me.
That shot, because that was always a really good chance to happen. But, yeah, I mean, if you took it... It's hard when you play with friends, sometimes you want to see them as well, but when it was tall, and I thought, if he'd taken his chances here before, he would have won already. That's when I thought, well... Alright.
Yeah, you got to lose the life there.
Yeah.
It's 2-2, and you probably know it should have been 4-0 at that stage.
Definitely.
Yeah.
With how I was playing, if I was 3-1 down, I would have taken it.
Yeah.
To be 2-2 less, and I thought, well.
Jemo's bad shot selection there, Nathan. He's actually given Jamie the opportunity to do this, and now he has to work.
Yep.
He's got two shots, but.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, he really had a chance to. And the thing is a lot of people, particularly with the ones that are sort of learning the tactics and things like that, they don't look at the black as a positive thing if they hit it. Like you know, they always look at how they can move their ball, and sometimes even, you know, what you can do to their ball. But the black ball, sometimes they just ignore that, and they can really win you a lot of frames by moving that around as well.
Well, now you'd have to say Jamie's definitely favourite.
Absolutely, yeah, after that, yeah.
And Steve went from... Yeah, that's what I was thinking, Mark. Mark's just pointing out exactly what I was thinking, but it's he's got two shots. He's gone off the other one. Mark just said, pot the ball over. He just potted over the pocket and bring the ball out near the black spot, but a bit higher and a bit just before the black spot, and come pot the other red into the middle pocket that's next to the yellow in the middle of the table, and try to extract the red and the black that are on the rail.
Something like that.
Takes control. Would have been some good shots, but he sort of put himself in that position there. Then again, he might be able to pot this now and then play that. If he can get across the table and get a half ball pot on the red, he's gone too far. He would have had a good angle to actually come off the rail and play this attractive shot too.
That's actually not too bad.
Yeah, but he's got to get the black out and control the shot, mate. Yeah. Oh, hello. Yeah. He did have that angle.
I thought he had a good angle. Yeah.
Now, if he pots this in one, well, he's favourite, but he has to get the black out of here. He has to pot the ball. Yeah, nice. Well, you had to, Mark, really. He had to get the black out.
We all said the same thing. It was a foul. And Colby, Jamie won the frame anyway, so don't worry, it's all good. Alright, so after that little bit of a blemish there, he was able to just roll through and get the white back out in the middle, and yep. And could we see a Robbo solid final?
Was this was a final. Those two played in the final. Or was it a semi they played a couple of tournaments ago? Gus won the last one of these, didn't he? Gus did Georgia. He was the last.
Yeah, I think Gus did win the last one. I wasn't here, but I heard that he did win that. So, yeah.
Well, it's definitely a Jamie Stevens Mark Roberts final. Yep, but I think Jamie may have lost in the final to Mark the one before.
Okay. Yeah. And there we go. There's a little bit of a fist pump from
Jamie. Jamie, is this your second final against Mark? Is this your second final against Mark?
Have you made the final in this before?
Mate, I don't think I've got past the first round.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
I told you you'd be commentating the final.
When did he beat you last?
Who,
Jamie?
What was
that in? Oh, that was Good Friday comp. That's past the end. Oh, that's right, yeah. Yeah. I've got tournaments mixed up here. But Jamie did say I would be commentating on him in the final today, and absolutely correct.
All right, so we're running a little bit later than normal here, so it's normally we've got the comp wrapped up around about this time, but got one more match, so I'm sure all the pool players that don't really rate going to bed early will be enjoying the fact that this is still going.
Okay, who's favourite in this match? No, you still have to go with Mark.
Well, yep, you Marks, do. Marks. Hey, again, yeah. I need a reason to not pick him. Runs are on the board.
It's true.
See you, mate. See you Tuesday. See you, mate. No,
the red in the corner, you hit it too hard. I'll be here, yeah.
I was going to say, if we're still here by the time you get here, that's all right, yeah. Yeah, we haven't gone home. Yeah. Hang on, what's going on here?
Mick's just come over into the commentary box. Viagra, he's offering us Viagra. I don't quite need that just yet, mate, but thanks. But you got any of that gel? That works well, apparently. YK, fucking whatever it is.
Not sure if we've got any. If someone just let me know, either text me or whatever. Just if there's
any comments.
Pitches working all right. If there's no technical issues. Anything like that. Just want to make sure it's all good.
You missed any comments here? I don't think so. Not much happening with the comments.
Someone just asked me what happened with JMO's second visit. Well, he just lipped his last ball, and then Jamie went out.
I'll be back in a second, mate.
All right. No worries. That's also not a bad idea. We'll just have a take a quick couple of minute break, and we'll come back and start the final.
When I was around 9 or 10 years old, at a place called I think it was UQ2 in Ringwood. That was my dad's venue. Then he bought it, and then it became my classic Q. So I think we first started playing off there about 9 or 10 years old. Yeah,
I first started playing pool when I was 10 or 11.
I started mucking around on my parents' pool table when I was about 4 or 5 years old. First played competitive pool when I was about 12 or 13.
12 years of age, used to play in my garage at home. We had a pool table. Then I give that away, and I hit a snooker table when I was 17, and so the story goes.
I was about 16 or 17. There was a pinball parlour, of all things, in Ballarat, which I used to frequent and just play arcade games, and then sort of had a... I know, I've always liked the game. I was absolutely terrible at it when I first started, and then a place called Chalk It Up opened in Ballarat, and I just got the ball rolling from there. I haven't stopped playing since, pretty much.
When I first played pool, we had a table in the house, pretty much growing up. I reckon I was probably first had a cue in my hand, probably 7 or 8. Started playing, you know, early teens, maybe a fraction younger, but started playing competitively. I actually played snooker and beards competitively first when I was about 15 or 16, and then started playing competitive pool at about 17 years old,
I've always kind of bashed around at home. My parents had a half-size snooker table, but only really started playing seriously when I was 21. Made the inter-varsity team for my university, and played the inter-varsities, and then got the bug, really, and moved to England then and started playing a lot more in England. The pool scene's pretty big there. So, yeah, I was 21, really.
Which player inspires you the most?
It's a really hard one, because there's a lot of different aspects of the game, and a lot of those aspects, different players do inspire me. I'd have to say, in the modern day, I'd have to say Jake, because, well, he smashes me every time I play him now, and why I taught him a lot about the game when he was young, he's teaching me a lot about the game now, which is helping me improve my game, so... Yeah, probably him and probably Benny Noonan as well, just with his ability to just free fly around the table and make it look so easy. They're probably my two most inspiring players.
I used to watch a few. Quinton Hand was definitely one of them. And Ronnie O'Sullivan, he's probably still my idol to this day.
Neil Robertson gives me the most inspiration in this game because I got to see...
Alright, so best of 9, final started. Jamie Stevens versus Mark Robertson. I've got a bit of a cold, so if I'm a bit nasally, then it's you're bad. How are you, Brett?
Good, mate. You wouldn't be feeling too good after that, I would imagine.
Nah, I've been actually sick with the flu for the last few days. It's feeling a bit lightheaded at the moment.
Yeah, you played a few uncharacteristic shots, we thought.
Yeah, the table to me right now, all my body is just swaying.
Oh, okay, all right.
Swaying. Not using excuses, but...
No, look.
I wasn't myself. I was struggling.
Yeah, I could see that. A couple of your shot selection was...
I actually can't think properly right now. I don't even know what I'm doing talking. But all credit to Mark in another final. He's going to make this 5 out of 6 if he gets this.
And Jamie too.
Jamie just missed the cannon there.
Yeah, he was sort of never going to hit that the way he was playing it, but...
No, I thought maybe...
Hit it a bit low, didn't he, Mick?
Yeah.
You got a big match tomorrow night with Steve Jemison.
Yeah, looking forward to that. Hopefully I can play a little bit better. I'll just feel a little bit better, hopefully, tomorrow.
And Peter Butterworth playing...
Kurt Dunham. Yeah, it should be two good matches, hopefully. The winner out of Kurt and Butters plays Robbo in the semis, and the winner out of myself and Jamo plays
Justin
Campbell, yeah. So, Jamie just playing a bit of a containing shot there.
I'd say Mark would be looking to get this ball on the left-hand side of the table over the pocket, wouldn't he, Mick? How does he get to it, though?
Could play the one in the centre first.
Yeah, he came up with the end, yeah, he's got the right...
And then come and block the pocket, but...
Is it a bit thin, though?
He might...
Trying to double this... Double it onto the yellow.
Yeah.
Yeah, double it onto the yellow on the rail. Yeah.
Trying to confuse things a little bit.
Yeah, he's played this pretty well by the looks of things.
Not bad.
Very good shot.
Great shot.
Well played. So what do you think Jamie will be doing here? He's trying to rest on the red.
Might even be clearing it. Yeah, he's cleared it. It's not a bad shot.
Yeah.
Mark's still got two dodgy yellows on the right. And plenty of
balls to get into them, Mick. But then Jamie had to put himself back in the frame, didn't he?
That's right.
Yeah.
And Jamie was behind then.
Yeah,
so
definitely.
Now it's...
obviously, Mark's benching us out and the snook beyond there, beyond that yellow. Yeah, but you're right. Jamie had to put himself, give himself a chance.
Jamie's running out of options now. Jamie, captain of Victoria this year.
Yeah.
Very good. I think he deserves it.
It's his first time, is it?
Yeah, first time as captain.
I heard him saying before, this is his 13th, 14th stateside or something.
Yeah, he's made an absolute bucket load. I think he deserves to be captain. Is it... For himself, really. He's a good talker. Plays well out there. He's got all the experience in the world.
And you're vice captain with Kurt?
With Don Colbert.
With Don Colbert.
Yeah, but couldn't be more happy that Jamie's captain. Looking forward to it. So, I think he was looking at maybe coming off two rails and hoping to hit a red on the way back up the table, but. Going to roll this in. I don't really like that.
No, I don't think it's well.
Only because.
Yeah, there is a starter in the middle.
Well, Mark can just glance off the red, the yellow and the red, and open them up and then roll in just about all the other balls.
That's true.
So, he doesn't really need a starter here.
Yeah, that's
true.
He
just opens up his first dead ball and he can roll in just about this out. So, but on the other hand.
He's forced him to do it.
That's right.
Yeah.
So if he stuffs up now, then Jamie's probably favourite. But
so I may have come off off the top rail, off the side rail, and tried to hit the red in the middle of the table and push the yellow up the top tail.
Yeah.
A lot of risk in it, obviously. And if I miss the red, I give him two shots too, so...
Yeah.
So it was a pretty fair shot that Jamie played, actually. It's made Mark actually go here.
Yeah. So Mark's done what we said. Even tried to possibly, maybe even pot that yellow in the centre as well. But it's gone up the table, which is fine.
Going to play to get on the ball that he just knocked up the rail after
this.
That's
it. And he wants to try and land on the cushion here.
Yeah, that's right. That's perfect.
Yeah.
Well, not exactly perfect, actually. Does he roll through this?
Yeah, I'd say he rolls through towards the red.
He can screw off it anyway, at worst. Come back down the table.
I think
it looks like he can run through this, doesn't it?
Yeah, run through and land near the red at the top end of the table.
Yeah, it's
he wanted to nudge into it.
Contact on the red.
But if he rolls in this yellow now, which is dodgy, then he still has a chance at the out here. But Jamie has forced him to do this.
Well, this is the perfect example of Jamie's shot and why it wasn't a bad shot selection, because...
Well, he's probably going to lose the frame regardless.
That's right,
so rather than try and do what you said before and try and bump a yellow up there and maybe hit his red,
yep.
You know, he's basically said, okay, Mark,
yeah,
two shots
out.
Here. Yeah. Yep. But if it goes wrong here, then Jamie has
Jamie's favourite,
so,
no
yeah,
doubt.
That's right.
And it has. Well, there you go. There's the value of Jamie's shot.
I think Mark's just knocked that yellow in front of that black now. So Jamie's just checking it. You'll see by his body language.
No, it must be on. He didn't.
Yeah. He didn't look up at the sky or anything like that. So it looks like the black's on. So. I want to try and clear these two bottom ones first. And then he can float down for the black off one of the top reds. Preferably the top left red.
That's right, yep.
It's a good shot.
Yeah, it's perfect. Just bounce out the three-quarter ball pot on the red.
Now, he's looking at his red, but this is not the shot.
That's the shot, the one over the hole.
Exactly right. So come out towards the bulk line. You can't really run too far on this.
That's
you can
right.
actually come halfway down the table, like on to the blue spot.
The only thing that can really go wrong is if he under hits this, which he won't.
That's right, like or that.
Like that. Well, he actually has a touch.
That was the only
now
way.
Yeah, that's this is.
That was the only way he could lose a frame by under hitting that. He was better off to overhitting it, even coming down the bottom, you know, even coming down past the blue spot, say like on a snooker table. He was still on this.
He's gonna have a tougher black than what. He's fine. There was nothing wrong with that angle at all.
Yeah, it looks weird from
here. Yeah.
But he's got this opportunity of giving Mark two shots, which not very many people do give him two shots because they're just afraid that he's going to pot out. But everyone does make mistakes. So I'm tipping Jamie's got about a half a pocket here, I would say.
Went off
the far. The other jaw,
yeah. So,
start for Jamie.
Jamie has won a frame just by simply putting himself in the frame.
That's it. I mean, fair enough, things have to go wrong for Mark, but, you know, they did, so.
It's a cracker, isn't it? Oh, knocked the black in.
Oh, didn't even see that. I was wondering what he was doing. Now, what's the bet that he smashes the pack this time? Nothing goes in and Jamie runs away. About $1.20 for that to happen. Or he screws straight in off.
It's an interesting that one went dumping the wide in on the break.
Yeah. But, I mean, the rule promotes, like, you know, for you to smash the pack, provokes positive pull, quick pull, in a way. So, you know.
You'd think we would have all learned by now not to do that,
though. Yeah, I know.
But we all seem to do it.
Oh, nearly did it. And there it is, not a ball in. Oh, now I got a red. So, first glance, reds look good.
Yes, definitely. Pot the one in the middle pocket and top rail, side rail, and extract the red on the right end rail.
Could
it
do
looks
that.
Like he has
or
a
just
perfect angle to do that right now for mine.
Could do that or just come up and down and play the double. And that way he's guaranteed not to go in off or do anything
well,
silly.
Well, I think it looks a pretty good angle to me, Mick.
Yeah,
just hit it high with a touch of right hand side. It looks like it's pretty big target. And you don't have to play with extreme force either.
Knowing Mark, I don't think he will play that shot.
No, generally not, yeah. I think me and you would be straight on it.
Yeah, I've tried to slow down a bit lately, so...
Well, personally, I think you play your best when you attack the game. That's my opinion. When you are playing your shots and you get into your rhythm, that's what I think you play your best.
So I'm pretty sure that red down the bottom right's still on. Mark's got to make the decision now whether to pull up here or to continue on with the frame. And if he wanted to, the ball that he's looking at now, he could play like half ball off that and run the white to the top left-hand pocket and sort of just sit the white up there.
Looks like what he's doing.
Well, they're doing that.
I don't think he's taking the pot on here, is he?
It looks like he's going wide, doing what I said, but... No. Yeah. That's fine.
But yeah, there looks like to be a gap that yellow can get underneath the red in ball.
But Mark knows he's going to get another visit here, so having that ball over the pocket in top right is very handy. So the pro, the singles elite league starts at 8 p.m. tomorrow.
Yeah, for those who are interested, two top matches.
And I think yourself and Mark will be commentating.
That's right, yeah. We've got you and Jemmo.
Jemmo, yeah.
And Jamie Kurt just and who is
Butters.
It? Butters, yeah.
So Jamie just covering the pocket there, or not covering the pocket, but just making things a little bit harder for Mark. Mark might even play the red on the yellow now and knocking the yellow out. That's probably what I'd be doing. Just you got to get rid of this yellow down the bottom right, yeah. So you can play the red directly into the yellow, and the yellow's going to hit the jaw.
And push the black up the table.
If you want, I don't think he's got the angle for that, but...
I think he may have, he's a thin.
Just exactly,
you're right, didn't he?
Exactly like that, yep. That was good shot. So now it puts the pressure back on Jamie. And that makes it a little bit easier for Mark now to pot out. And he's just keeping himself one step ahead right now, because he knows Jamie is looking to tie the frame up again. As soon as he does that, Mark's going to try and open it up again. He's not going to allow Jamie to do that. And vice versa, if Mark was doing that, Jamie's good enough to know what to do there. So.
Doesn't look that much of a shotty, Jamie. But he was beyond the eight ball in the last frame and managed to win it, so...
Yeah.
He's certainly beyond the eight ball in this frame, so...
Wow.
That mightn't be the worst result. If he can get to the potting angle, or if he can get enough of the yellow to even get this one on the left-hand side of the table in or over.
He might even be able to play the yellow that's to the far left, but...
Can it into the yellow?
Well, he can play the...
I don't think he's got that.
He can play the yellow in the middle of the table, middle of the three, and then cannon into the yellow on the left-hand side and try and push it over the pocket.
Yeah, I don't think he's got the angle to do that, Mick.
No?
No. I think he has got the angle to get this yellow over the hole, the one the closest to the left-hand side,
though.
Yeah,
he doesn't have to get over the hole, just get in front of the red.
In front of the red, yeah.
Just give it, yeah. Buy himself some time. Yeah.
Well, he definitely needs to block that red, there's no doubt about that.
Just start smothering balls.
Looks a bit dodgy, but oh no, he's fine. Bit hard. Yeah, a little bit hard.
He had to cover that red to buy himself one more shot.
Pretty hard to see Mark not getting these.
He's left himself a bit straight on here, so...
Yeah, but just screw back along the rail, pop the ball over the hole.
Yeah, that's it.
And just work your way down.
He might even be able to play this red off the yellow.
That looks like what he's doing. Rail first, into the red off the yellow.
Yeah, he's got to be careful he doesn't find the sweet spot between the pocket and hit the jaw and
that's
the yellow.
Right. 100%.
Like
yeah,
that.
Like he did.
Exactly like that.
Exactly as you called it, Mick.
And, and now... Jamie's got another
now,
chance.
Maybe the black may not even be on.
No, the black's not on now.
Well, the black, you can get rid of that with the red, though, that's near in the middle of the table.
That was the problem with Mark's shot. I know it's one in and you probably play that shot 20 times, it's 1 in 20, but it's a chance of happening. So, and Mark knew that too, but yeah. He's just thinking, well, what's the odds? And you're right, well, what are the odds? He played the percentages and copped one in the...
Yeah.
So Jamie was going to try and cover this. And that's he's a
good
done
shot.
That.
Very good shot.
Oh, well, Mark could play the red double.
He'd play the double there, wouldn't he? You'd have to think he will be. I don't think he's going to get a better opportunity than that.
Yeah, but having that black tied up is... I think, I don't know whether that red in the middle of the table can come off the black.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
I don't know how far the balls are down, but...
There's no doubt the red can go off the black. He's potted, no. Now, this is yellow. Can he get to that yellow next to the black, or is there a plant available onto it, or... Will it go? This is the question. If it does, you'd have to say that Jamie's a very good chance here.
I don't think it goes. Unless he's fat on it, it might roll in, but yeah. Now, I mean, if Jamie wanted to, he could tie the game up a little bit more, play the bottom right yellow, maybe try and go into one of those yellows in the middle of the table and then smother one of the other reds. That's no good.
No.
He really needed to get another foot and a half, 2 foot higher than that.
Off the rail, off the black and in the middle, Mick. Doesn't look like it's on, does it? Just looks a touch too far down the yellow.
I'd leave it. I'd leave it. I'd even maybe try and push that red that's near the black away if he can, but he's not on it. If he can...
We can't get to that. He's got an option to do that. Well, he's obviously trying to sit this right in front of the hole.
I'm surprised if this goes. He doesn't want to foul here.
Up the top.
Oh, wow. That's not a bad shot.
That's a great shot. Very good shot.
Mark's still got a chance to double that red back now with a red over the pocket, so... But... Putting Mark under the pump a little bit here. That wasn't a bad shot. If it went, Jamie's possibly out there, or gives himself another chance at the out. I don't mind that shot. So Mark's just got to avoid the in-off here in the centre pocket. Because he'd probably like to try and get up the table for this red.
Yeah, if he can get on that red and plant it onto the other one, the other corner.
Use
it's not a bad
red.
Angle to do it now, but it still takes a lot of control. This is very much a finesse shot, this shot.
Be very careful. Oh, wow.
Foul snooker. Do a lot harder than it looked to control that shot.
Yeah.
You're coming off three rails, obviously not using the balk rail. You're going to be using the top rail, side rail, and the left-hand top side rail.
Yeah. He was scared of the in-off. That's why he played it that way. He could have went higher up the rail, but he's obviously worried about the in-off. But
he's nominated the ball over the hole, which is, makes a lot of sense, obviously, because he retains two shots still.
He can drift down now.
Yeah, he can drift into the gap here.
Yeah, to where he was
three
before.
Oh, my God. No, which must have caught the jaw a bit there when he played that shot.
That's ugly.
Hmm. I'd say that's definitely one all now. That's the thing about these tables, though, Mick. They're deeper cut in the jaws. They're harder to control those shots at times, even though something that looks very simple is actually a lot harder than what it actually appears, because the deeper cut of jaws.
The cushions are quite bouncy too.
Yeah, they are. I was saying before that sometimes you pop balls on these tables, you think, you know, how did that go in clean? And other times you hit a shot more pure, and it doesn't go in.
Yeah.
So
Mark's actually still got to be careful.
It sort of it plays with your head a bit, in that sense.
Yeah.
Oh, you played that well. Yeah. Very well.
So just got to come around again, not as hard.
Yeah, just clear the path to the right-hand side of the table.
Just play it thin. Just shouldn't hit about 6-8 inches below the...
That's perfect. No, he's fine.
One all.
Jamie will definitely be kicking himself. It was a great opportunity to go 2-0 up. But
he, you know, you could always turn back and say, look, I'd probably take one all after the first frame.
Yeah,
so,
that's true.
You know. But against Mark, you know, you've got to take your chances.
We talk about conditions of, you know, you can talk about any code of Q Sports conditions. No, to be realistic, if we were playing, you know, all the players in Australia were playing on silk conditions all the time, obviously the pool would be a lot prettier.
Yeah, but crisper too. Like
yeah, but...
Pop position.
And this is sort of what you see at Nationals, Mick. Like,
yeah,
you know, you're playing on good cloth all the time and, you know, the tables are a pretty high standard. I haven't been there for a long time, but the times that I have gone... there's nothing wrong with the tables.
New, you know, re-clothed. They do skid a bit. Obviously, they're new. They do tighten up after about the first week. So...
And the players can play to their ability
those
conditions. Yeah. Whereas in these conditions here, they are tricky. Just like I, you know, stipulated before. Balls go in on these tables that...
Some tables are a bit easy.
And it changes from table to table. But you actually still do pop balls on you know, individual tables that... That going clean, that you think, how did that go in?
Yeah.
Like I said before, and then you hit one a lot more pure, and you expect it to go in, it doesn't go in.
Yeah.
So these sort of things bring you undone. Whereas when you're playing on decent conditions all the time, like at Nationals, you don't get that factor. It doesn't come into play. So, you know, a lot of times you see players, you think, oh, what a horrible shot. When you know people at home watching cue ball TV, but it's not the case. It's generally. There's more things out of your control and conditions like these, new cloth and stuff like that.
You're not worrying about the game, you're worrying about the table.
That's right, you've got to play each table individually on its merits, and you don't really know 100% what it's doing.
Yeah.
Unless you've had, you know, quite a bit of play on it. And that's the beauty of playing, like, you know, that's one of the reasons why I'm personally looking forward to that. You get up there, play on new cloth, you can enjoy your game, you know. It's, You don't have to dial that factor in.
That's exactly right.
Well, I think the ball just moved on Mark, and he's just saying he just rocked. I can see that you're trying to say that, but we didn't actually see it move.
It's moved sideways, and it's just slowly rocked. I didn't feather it.
No, we know you didn't touch it. I'm pretty... Yeah. Do you want us to check it?
Yeah, just...
Can we check that then? Yeah, no, Dale, quite possibly it's moved. We're just talking about table conditions just right now.
So you want to put the ball back? You're trying to be a cheat?
Well, actually, that's completely fucked up the shot. Cause I don't know. I have to play that with maximum sight, and I'm like,
why? I don't think you can actually put the... put it back, Mark.
No,
it has to stay where it is now.
Yeah,
even though you haven't touched it, and it's out of your control, you can't actually.
Yeah.
Just now.
Now he'll get down.
Now you're about to get
you
down
touch
on
the
your
cloth. Reckon? Obviously. Yeah. Yeah, you probably pushed the cloth towards the ball. Sorry, guys. We'll just 10 seconds. I was having a look. Yeah. What's the red dot?
It's obviously changed the angle of your shot. Yeah. Yeah, right. Yep. Yeah, right. Unbelievable.
Yeah, we just looked at the replay.
Classic.
The ball did move about a centimetre.
Well, there you go. We're just talking about conditions, and this is what can happen. generally doesn't happen on new cloth.
Yeah, So the red ball was on what he was aiming for, but it's now not on.
Mark, there's not much you can do about that except just cop it sweet. Now he's totally different thought process now.
It's probably slowed him up. I mean, the out was probably a bit stupid anyway.
Well, if that red and balk's on, not really.
He should try and feather the other way and push it back the other way. That's probably a better shot, because this out was a little bit dodgy.
Yeah, you're right,
a little
bit dodgy. It might have done him a favour.
Yeah, I think
the
I
red
think
must
has.
Be on, though, for Mark to even be thinking about the out, the one in Bork. It must
be
on.
Yeah, I would say so. Nick. If it looks sort of dodgy from here, it's probably on.
Yeah. That was like half a ball.
It was at least a centimetre.
Yeah. Classical. Right, Jamie's actually... I think Jamie will be taking this out of you, Mick.
Yeah, well, he probably wasn't expecting a shot.
No. He definitely took the out on there. Now he's certainly opened it up for Mark, but it's certainly not easy.
No, well, that black's still a bit dodgy.
Well, even the transition from ball to ball isn't... Yeah. You know, it's not ABC here.
If he wanted to now, he could play the ball in the top middle and stun across to the left-hand side of the rail. Well, but
and come back out. That must be on that red. For Mark to be contemplating the out, it must be on, I would imagine. The shot before I'm talking about.
Yeah.
So, if he screws off this, then we know that red's definitely on. But if he dollars it over the hole, we'd have to think that it's not.
Yeah, that top red, I think it goes in the top left. I'm not sure if it goes on the top right. But if it does, he can probably just stun across. Unless he plays this hard. And
he's
stuns.
Scoring off it. He's certainly playing this with pace, so it must be on. Yeah. Knock the black out off this, Mick?
Yeah, I like it.
You're fed on the ball in the middle still.
That's right, and if you miss it, you come past.
That's right, you come down the table and you can clear up this end first.
But if anything, you want to try and miss the black to the high end so you don't get in off.
Yeah, absolutely. Which means you've got to navigate the second yellow on the rail too. You've got to just miss that to knock the black out here.
Well, I think if you stun sort of straight up towards the nameplate with a bit of right-hand side,
sharpen it right up.
Yeah. It'd be stiff not to be on a red here.
Well, he's bridging over the black a bit.
Yeah, I probably wouldn't.
So he won't be trying to knock it out now, I wouldn't imagine. Actually, I don't think that was on.
No. Wasn't on if he's played it like that. Well, there's another chance here for Jamie.
Doesn't look like he knocked the black out off this shot, so yeah, no, he didn't have the angle. Ooh, it's a bit fortunate there. This is a bit close for comfort for mine. Power with the one in the middle now, Mick, and knock the ball off the top rail.
I don't think the angle's on. I think it's too thick.
The higher one.
Yeah, I think it's too thick.
You reckon?
Yeah. I'd probably be just trying to land behind it. That's a silly... Not... Yeah, it's not good.
It's a what sort of shot, Michael?
Yeah, they're good.
What do you do here?
Not that. I think he has to play the ball over pocket now.
He has to continue on with the air, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Bounce out in the middle of the table here, land on these two balls first. The yellow on the ball crow looks to go inside the red.
Yeah. He really wants to get up to that top
quickly.
Yellow. Yeah. I don't know whether that red is covering the whole pocket at the top. So maybe the yellow might go underneath that red at the top.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it will.
Maybe. He's got a good angle now.
Good angle now to get on the other side of it. Yep.
Yeah. So. Now, he wants to sort of hit where the bulk line meets the cushion. That's pretty much where he wants to stun into.
100%.
And then sort of land on the back rail would be actually quite nice, in a way.
So what Michael's just trying to explain there is actually screw deeper into the rail to create an angle to come out and up to the top rail with missing the red. Well, Jamie's going about this. It must go underneath it.
Yeah, it must go in the
other pocket.
The way
he's played this, it has to go underneath it quite comfortably, you'd imagine. Otherwise, I'd say you would have been playing the way Michael just explained. He hit the balk rail, the actual line on the rail. That's where you want to hit the...
Yeah.
That's where the contact needs to be.
And you just want to land high or low on that top rail.
So
it, that top
what
ball.
That does is create... Even if you don't create an angle, you're right off the rail and you can still work the white. So that's a good angle for Jamie. Very good angle. If he's this must go pretty clean, Mick, I think.
No, I think he needed more angle than this. He really needed to be about another 6 inches lower.
You don't reckon it's clearly on?
No. No. I don't think so. I think he really needed that white to be down lower.
Yeah, the reason why Michael's saying it needed to be 6 inches lower is so he can actually glide the yellow in off the red then without any force.
And then the white can come down
the table. The white will float down the table, so...
But right now he's got to play with pace with yellow.
We're about to find out right here.
Yellow could sit over the pocket here.
That's right, exactly.
He's actually played that really well.
He still, he would have preferred to be a touch further down the table and get on the other side of the black.
Yeah. Now this is...
Now, these kind of shots are funny on these tables, Mick.
Yeah.
I mean, you can hit this pretty well and miss it, and hit it not as well and get it.
Yeah.
This is one of the shots I'm sort of talking about.
On this table, I'd be rolling it down there.
And just hope it hugs the rail and just falls in when it hits the jaws.
If you hit it hard, it's no chance.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's...
Like that. That's exactly what Michael said.
You're going to lose the frame anyway if you miss.
That's
right. So put the ball in or over. Give it every chance.
Absolutely.
Don't bash it. He's probably turned that into a 1 in 50 shot.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Rolling it down, you're probably going to get it 1 in 7.
Yeah.
1 in 6 maybe. 1 in 8, I don't
maybe
know.
More, actually, yeah.
You know. But hitting it that hard, Mark's got to make the out.
Yeah,
or put you in stripe. So.
You can't see Mark not making this out.
No. And the thing is, with the black over the pocket, it puts us
a little bit of pressure,
pressure,
yeah. And he could have the white heart up on the right, even though he'd still have a starter in the middle into the top pocket.
Yeah, well, the thing
is... You can miss anything in this game, and the black's sitting over the hole. He knows he can't miss.
Yeah, the difference is the starter might be the bottom ball over the pocket, the bottom left-hand...
Yeah,
bottom part of the table.
True.
So,
yeah.
You know. Mark's expecting his first baby in about 7 weeks.
Yes, congratulations to Susie and Mark on that. Everybody's obviously stoked for him, but the only downside of that, well, there isn't a downside. There is no downside. It just means that Mark won't be the national representative of Victoria.
At this stage, no.
At this stage. But
the baby's due on the 12th.
But there isn't a downside to it.
No downside.
But he's got plenty of years left to do that.
Well, not really. His baby will turn one when we leave again next year.
That's true. Susie might keep him for the birthday.
That's it.
May have another one on the way by then for
all
we
know. Yeah, that's it. So, yeah, in 7 weeks, he's going to be a different person. He's going to have responsibilities other than himself. Oh, he got a massive kick.
Was a kick, was it?
Big kick. I heard it in the background before he actually hit the ball. Well, on the TV screen.
Actually, that could make a difference here.
Well, I'd be playing probably the bottom ball now.
Yeah.
The middle ball or the.
Yeah, but if he misses it, he actually leaves Damien on double.
Yeah. Well, I don't think he's got a choice.
No. Well.
Yeah, not a bad angle there.
He has missed it. Look at this. See, different conditions, different... What can happen? And you do find, too, this venue, you do get a lot of kicks, Mick. I've experienced a lot myself here. It's just because the gloves are older, tables are more, the balls are dirty.
Yeah, but...
It's not... And
I don't know. At my table at home, it's in very good condition and new balls, and I still get kicks.
You get a lot of kicks.
One in three, one in four shots.
Are you serious?
It's ridiculous. It's the worst thing I've ever seen.
Jesus, that's horrific. Well, there you go.
And that's 8 ball for you.
This has been 3 interesting frames of pool up to date.
Yeah, well, it could have been 3-0 Mark, could have been 3-0 Jamie.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's the way the cookie crumbles.
Yeah, that's a very high ratio of kicks.
Yeah, it's, one it's, in every it's four ridiculous. Shots is ridiculous. I'm literally, yeah. I'm not joking. No, I don't think so.
I think you had to roll at Jamie on these tables.
I think he hit it wide. What it?
Well, Jamie just querying why he reckons he hit that black perfect up the roller when he jaw it, but on these tables, on some tables you can play those kind of shots in this venue, and others you just can't. So you have to roll and take the risk of the ball just getting to the pocket and falling in somehow.
Yeah, that's right.
But there is some tables you can actually pump them.
Yeah.
Comes back again, just what I was saying before about nationals and stuff like that. You don't have to deal with that factor at national titles, which is a very nice place to be. But I will say one thing about this venue and the tables. I absolutely thought these tables were repulsive when the big guns time was on. That was my opinion of them.
Yeah,
and they've been fixed since, and they're quite good tables now. They're all right. They're
fine. All run pretty good.
Yeah,
they all do run
pretty good. At the time when the big guns storm was on, these tables were shocking.
Yeah.
That was my personal opinion. I don't think you could play good 8-ball on these tables, to be honest.
Yeah.
But JR certainly, Georgia got straight onto that, and she done something about it straight away, and these are more than playable conditions
now. Georgia spent a lot of money to get these tables as good as they can be, and yeah, they are.
She's done her best to give us the best conditions we can have.
That's right. Good so, venue.
Yeah, it is a great venue.
I was actually hoping that the Nationals in Melbourne would be here.
Yeah, that'd be good. This is a very good venue for 8-ball, no doubt about it. Plenty of space and lots of tables. But next year it's in Albury.
It's in Albury. Yeah. Albury, Melbourne.
Yeah.
So Jamie's just tried to nick off the yellow there. So this game's turned into to like third division pool right now. But it is about midnight or something, isn't it now?
Yeah, it's
it's midnight.
Gemma's just joined us in the commentary here. He's just sitting behind us and looking at the screen here with us.
Gemma, I think what you should do between now and tomorrow, I think you should drink as much as possible.
We're just saying before, you're getting used to the game, mate. You're starting to be understand the little white. It's obvious you know what you're doing with the little white now, and you're certainly improving rapidly because you've got a lot of knowledge in Q Sports, obviously, Steve. You know,
very good ambassador for the game.
Yeah, and Steve does his best to try and promote this game, and it's more than what 999 million other people try to do. So, yeah, it's big. Hats off to you, mate. So Dan with Cueball TV, so we can sit there and watch these two muscle men out there at the moment.
Set.
These two weightlifters playing pool. Jamie told me he's back in the gym. I've been around your joint, Michael, and there is a full gym set at your place. So
yeah, we've been.
And I think you both have been using it by the looks of yours.
Been using it now for about the last 3 months, quite solid. So we're actually trying to trim weight at the moment. Lose about 5 kilos each. And Jamie just giving Mark two shots there.
There's no doubt, you know, a healthy body's a healthy mind. I mean, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we've started running too the last 3 days. Started running as well every day, and you do feel better. Like I've done 3 runs now at like 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night, and it's amazing. Once you start running and breathing in the air and stuff like that, the cold air, it's actually really good.
Yeah, I think it all contributes to being successful, doesn't it? No doubt about it. You might come back with an Australian title this year, Mick.
That's what I'm looking. I'm looking to do that, yes.
It'd be nice if the Australian titles do come back with a Victorian.
Yes, always. But main goal is the teams. And,
yeah, absolutely.
The I'd love to.
Well, mate, I'm dropping the bit to get to Darwin. I think I'm gonna have a great time up there, and great to get up there and play some good pool, and some good competitive pool, and the highest level you could play in the country. You'd be really looking forward to it. It's been quite a while for myself, so.
I'm some good people up there too.
Mm.
Some good people.
Well, you get you good and bad everywhere, don't you? But I think, as a rule, I've played, obviously played a lot of snooker in my time and been involved in 8-ball for a long time. And, I haven't come across too many dickheads. I'll use the word dickhead.
Well, you have it in every sport.
You know what
though.
I mean?
Yeah, you have it in every
just
sport.
Just absolute,
though.
Most people, they're pretty good people, I find, so.
Every sport has their egos, and you've got to have
a
bit of ego.
Yeah, it's a very egotistical game, there's no doubt about it.
Yeah. You've got to have an ego to actually get anywhere in any game, really.
Mm.
So Jamie just wasting a shot here.
Yeah, I think we'll see Jamie definitely go game here.
Yeah, this is looking tall, unless we have an in off or something. Something crazy. Seen some crazy stuff over the last couple of frames. It's amazing how a kick can change a frame too.
Yeah.
Change the way you think. I remember.
I got one against Steve Jamison. I got a massive kick on a ball. Was rolling. He actually had. I left him a shot at a black. He should never had a shot at. He actually missed the black and still won the frame.
Yeah.
But it does get in your head when stuff like that happens.
So do you know where this bottom red's going?
No.
Oh, sorry, he's on. Yeah, red.
I can't.
He's only got one.
I don't know what he's
too.
Trying to do here, Jamie. Just,
I remember Mark getting a kick in the Whitehorse tournament about 4 or 5 years back. I think it was. Maybe longer. I'm really bad with time. At 4-all. And he was just about blew up. Wanted to flip the table and stuff. But, it's the way. He still won the match. But, the copper kick in any situation of a game can really make you...
Yeah,
make you
that's right. Especially in this game, because it's such a critical... It's such...
Yeah,
millimeters. A mistake is critical in this game, so... In snooker, you score 45, 50, 60 points, and you get a kick.
Yeah.
Okay. If your opponent's a top-line player, you left the balls open, it's pretty much an even-money bet from there. But it's still an even-money bet.
Wow, that is an unbelievable shot.
But in this game, it's like, you go from, 90-10 to 10% instead of 90% in one shot. So, it's critical.
So I wonder if Jamie's actually been putting any time in at home. He's looks to be quite confident with whatever he's doing out there. So
I think he may be.
Very good signs for Nationals.
Hmm. And he thinks of all his options, Jamie, before he pulls the trigger, doesn't he?
Yeah. So what do you do here, Brett? You screw back.
Well, I don't know. I think you've got to actually play this off the jaw into the yellow and screw back the side. Yeah. You've got to try and go out here. Or maybe you don't need the side. Maybe you can use two rails and bounce back into the middle of the table, Mick. Yeah.
What if
side rail?
Yeah. Maybe just screw back to the rail and play the long red. Hopefully it doesn't roll.
Well, I think you're more chance of actually potting the ball the harder you play this shot, Mick. It's going to bounce off the yellow more. So,
he can play it hard, but maybe screw back not as far. Oh, wow. He sort of just threw the cue.
Well, he played your shot, yeah. Maybe he just didn't get through that properly.
No, I don't think so. I think he sort of just...
He sort of threw
the cue at it a bit. It was a difficult shot.
No doubt.
So Mark just glides up on the cushion.
A lot
here.
Of times you find matches that the win and loss comes from a shot like that.
Yeah.
The bloke that actually gets it on the day and the one that doesn't. That's the game we're playing. But it's especially short distance. There's a lot of airside influences that come into play. But for mine, that's what's so good about the game.
So really wants to play the bottom left-hand ball to last. So he'll probably just bounce out towards the dot here, basically,
where he is now.
Yeah. And if anything, you want to come too far because you still got options. You don't want to like that. That's a little bit short. Yeah.
Well, Mark, I think he will still find him screw off this with seismic. I don't think he'd be going side rail and underneath the black.
No.
On a snooker table, you'd probably play it that way. But with a smaller white, it can get away from you, you know?
Yeah.
So it looks like he's screwing straight off. Well, he's looking at the angle. Maybe he has to play underneath the black. Once again, on different conditions, this is a lot trickier shot. When you're on tables, you know exactly how they're reacting. This isn't that hard a shot. But
he just wants to come up near the middle pocket.
He's taken
and
this option.
That's a good shot.
He's guaranteed himself a shot at the black.
Anywhere up near the middle pocket, or middle of the table, I mean.
Well, it's pretty obvious what Mark's done here. He's elected to take a harder pot on the black, but guaranteed himself a shot. So he's backing himself.
Just got to watch he doesn't knock the ball in down the bottom left hand.
Yeah, I don't think. He was aware of the situation there. He fell a bit short and didn't want. He wanted to make sure he had a shot at the black, and that's exactly what he done there.
So it hasn't really been a ripper of a match, but look, at the end of the day, it is after midnight, and it is tough being out there.
It's best of seven, is it? Oh, this is best of seven. It's not best of nine. Open table. I think we're about to see the reds in play.
You play the yellow one or the red?
Yeah, why not? Yeah, this red down here in the top looks to go underneath that yellow, so they all look on to me. Or does Mark leave that first and get rid of the plant situation?
Yeah, I agree.
And I think he probably leaves that
definitely.
There.
That could even be a last ball too.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, he gets rid of the plan situation definitely before moving that ball over the hole.
I reckon he might stun this in and then play the double.
Well, this ball next to the yellow may be on underneath.
Yeah.
Or he's trying to hit the yellow. He's trying to hit the yellow.
Yeah, definitely. What do? You just knock both those reds out?
Yeah, you can. I think that's a logical thing to do, Mick.
Jamie's not really going anywhere.
Might try and tie
Mark up, but you really want to get these two reds out in open play.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a logical thing to do. Bounce them both out.
Yeah, very good shot.
That's
perfect. Doesn't want to kill that red.
Still all right.
Mark's annoyed, so I'm tipping that red's gone dead. Yeah, he's looked away, he's shaking his head. Talking to the roof. So he's killed that red.
But Jamie's got nowhere to go really, has he? Even if he powers this yellow in the middle, where does he go from there? There's no position off this ball.
Might even just knock this yellow out. Just get it out. He's trying to cover it.
Yeah, Mark's got to be firm favourite here, surely.
But the thing is with that shot, Mark can now just play the red onto the yellow in the middle of the table.
Just
play with everything and open everything right up.
That's right. But to be fair, I don't think Jamie had much choice there. What was he going to do, Mick? What, pot the ball in the middle, then what? He's on nothing.
Maybe the yellow that he hit, maybe he can get that out of there.
When Mark
can't do the shot that I said before about just smashing all the balls open. Because now Jamie can sort of pot out or sort of do something better. That shot that he tried to do was really hard. And even if he got it right, Mark's still
favourite
because he played the red onto the yellow.
Just a retaining shot, wasn't it?
Yeah, but
at best.
I think he might have had a better...
But it's a pretty open table if he actually clears the path to that red, though, let's face it.
Mark's still had two dodgy reds.
Well, Mark's got plenty of balls to work with to knock put them into position. So.
But he's not playing that well right now, too. So
yeah, that's true. Yeah.
You know, you got to think about that as
He's not playing at his best, that's for sure.
No, a few things have gone wrong. He's had a kick. Like, you know, things are on his mind. So maybe Jamie can try and, if he wanted to.
Well, you got a point, actually, because Jamie couldn't manufacture any out from by doing that. Yeah, so.
So I'd be looking at trying maybe covering another one of Mark's balls, maybe the bottom, that yellow that he's looking at now, try and cover the bottom left-hand red. Slows the game right up. Mark's still got a couple
tricky
of
tricky shot
reds
to cover these, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, you've got to judge the pace absolutely
even
primo.
Even come off the bottom rail and make... I don't like that.
No, he's overhit that. Yeah, that wasn't going to do a lot because he just gets it out again.
Yeah, that's right. He had to cover one of Mark's balls there. I still think if you put that yellow over the bottom left-hand corner and just covered it. Mark wants that in.
Great shot. So that's the example I was talking about. Some balls go in, you don't think you're going to go in.
Yeah, yet. That's right.
That's that sort of thing.
Just to be careful here. He might be able to play the plant down the bottom left and sort of drift up towards
the middle
of the table.
I think he's
going to
have a go
here. He could play the plant in the bottom left and drift up towards the middle table and open up that yellow and red if he wanted to.
Actually, I'm not too sure he's going to have a go at it. Could be one shot too soon. Come on, man.
Yeah.
He needs to get that ball out in the open. Get it into the clear.
He needs to get a better position, so he might take one of these balls first.
He could pop this plant over the pocket and actually glide into the red.
Yeah, that's what I said before, but I think he's just going to...
I think he's going to play that now, actually, Mick. He's going to just try and nudge it.
I think he might land behind it, play the red up the top of the table.
Do you reckon it goes up the top?
He's looking at it, and it looks close from here, so if it looks close, I would say it's on. Well, he's going to play the... I know what he's going to do, yeah. He's going to play the red on the red and make the white stun across the table to play that middle red
into
the
top
red,
left-hand pocket.
Into the bottom left-hand corner. So he's just going to stun the white ball to the side rail.
Yeah, it must be on. He wouldn't be going this way. It'd have to be on that shot, what you just said. Oh. Otherwise, he wouldn't have gone that way. Oh, well, Jamie, if he can get angles to get that ball out next to the two reds. Very, very difficult, but there is a... No, I can't really see. It's going to take some precision here to go out, isn't it?
If I was Jamie here, I'd be just trying to obviously get...
Leave him off this red in the middle of the table.
Yeah, even pot your yellow and try and push both those yellows over those... See the ball that he just went for then?
Mm-hmm.
I'd probably try and pot that and then play the yellow on the yellow and sort of push those yellows...
Inside the yellow red.
Just over the
top.
Yeah,
what about
the
free ball factor, though?
No, you don't foul. I'm pushing both those yellows in front of the reds. Just slow the game up completely.
Mm.
It gives you more time to work something out. Because he's giving Mark...
Mark won't be
happy
with that.
Good. No.
He's going to have to screw down the cushion here.
Yeah, he's not. He's going to have to leave himself a long pot.
Then he's got to get back on the black.
Yeah, well...
If he leaves himself on the cushion...
He could just...
Come out a bit, yeah.
He can come off the top rail and knock the black in the centre that way if he had to, but...
That's true, yeah.
You're thinking weird stuff when you're tired. Yeah, so where he's looking at now is where he'll play
it's
it.
It's obviously on that red, because he would never have...
Yeah, definitely,
he wouldn't
yeah.
be contemplating even potting this ball in a million years if it wasn't, so...
You know, Mark the... I was going to say, he could just roll up to that red, but he can't because of the other yellows.
It's a different layer of the table now, isn't it?
Mm.
It's definitely on. He's overhit.
Wow.
It was definitely on, though, obviously. He'd never taken that option.
No, I don't even think he thought he could get that much of the ball, too. So, Jamie
becomes favourite once again for
this
frame.
Best of seven, not best of nine, so...
Can't even fluke this, Mick. Can you? I can't see anything. Can you?
I think I still might got the top right. Just gotta have a
surely he would have played it before that if it goes up to the top right.
No, but he's worried about the other red two being up there.
I don't think it was on me. No.
All right, Jamie.
He tried to get it out of the hole, obviously.
Mark's walked back to the chair there, says everything. And I think he's got to get up in about 6 hours too, so that'd be on his mind as well. Five for Dan.
Yeah.
And that's a ugly shot. Agree with Jamie, what he said there.
Yeah, he said, for fire's sake. Not quite. Work it out for yourself.
Got a feeling he might miss this ball.
Nah. I don't think he missed this, Mick. You really? Are a genius, Michael.
Really, Jamie? I had this feeling, like, he just didn't look right.
He did. Wow.
And he was annoyed about the shot before. I think he...
Oh, here it is. Yeah. Mark Roberts doing another an elite tournament.
5 out of 6, unless he misses this too. Maybe the black's not on. Maybe we've got to kick off the black.
It'd have to be a pretty big one to miss this. Well, there it is. Right. Well, thanks, viewers, for tuning in. On behalf of Dan, Michael, and myself, hope you've had an entertaining evening, and we'll see you again tomorrow night. Bye.
See you later. Thanks, Dan.